पुष्ट लग रहे हैं। अच्छा मैं हमेशा ही हिस्ट पुष्ट रहा हूँ, इसमें कोई नई बात नहीं।
अब आपकी संगति ऐसी रही है, क्या बताएं।
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल सही बात,
हसमुख लोगों के साथ।
और जया कैसे हैं आप?
बस गुड, जॉइनिंग अस नेक्स्ट सेमेस्टर।
होप सो। यस
यस या या दैट विल बी नाइस।
थैंक यू। तो मनोज जी क्या ऑब्जर्वर हैं? पार्टी ऑब्जर्वर क्या? व्हाट
इज या दैट्स अ पोलाइट वे ऑफ सेइंग
इट। पोलाइट वे ऑफ सेइंग इट।
या या
नहीं, आपका बड़ा बड़ा योगदान रहा है इसमें, ऐसी कोई बात नहीं।
हाँ हाँ बिल्कुल। और डोंट रब इट इन, आई नो आई डोंट वर्क वेरी मच।
कोई करना करना भी नहीं चाहिए ज्यादा। The semester is coming to an end now, the current one?
No such luck.
Achha, abhi time hai?
Yes, yes. Okay. Torture hota hai, to achhi tarah se hota hai, pura, abhi to almost 2 months.
Okay. Gunjan, I think we have not met earlier.
Yes, sir. So this is the first time we are meeting.
Okay. Good to see you.
And thank you for agreeing to be the jury member.
Always a pleasure.
Yeah.
And I get to meet my old friends.
Yeah.
Because the students, it's always a, you know, gives me a boost all the time.
This is the only bad
thing. Thank you so much.
Hello, everyone. Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
We can start now, huh? Mm-hmm.
Professor Devan is here.
I'm there.
Okay. Sorry, sir, I'm not able to see all.
No, sorry, I was on mute and I was keeping on saying something. So now I realize that nobody is responding.
It's sometimes better to be seen and not heard.
Yeah, not talking. For me, it's very good.
Okay. I think it's always better to be seen.
You can begin now.
Yes, Tilak.
It's 10 past. Start, ma'am? It's 2 past 10, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Are you sure?
Yes, Tilak. Hello. A very good morning to one and all. On behalf of the students of School of Planning and Architecture, Delhi, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all today for our seminar, Parivartan. You may be wondering, what is it today all about? As many of you may know, Parivartan is the Sanskrit word for change. In search of ways we can change the way we plan and design, the fourth-year students of the Department of Architecture are addressing two major current themes, the ongoing pandemic and climate change. These two events have shaped a new normal for us, changing some of the basic parts of life that we have up till now taken for granted. I request Joanne to take over now.
Thank you, Ayushi. We would now like to declare the seminar open by requesting Professor Dr. Ashok Kumar, Dean of Studies and the Acting Director, to give us the welcoming note.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Professor Anil Devan, Head of the Department of Architecture, Professor Anjana Mittal, and Architect Gunjan Jain, the coordinators, and dear students. I'm extremely happy to be part of this event for several reasons, but most important of all, the method that you have used to highlight some of the most important civilizational issues, I would say, through this series of seminars. You focused on two main areas, climate change and global pandemic COVID-19. Both, I would say you have picked up two subjects relating to global pandemics. Climate change, as it is unfolding, we see every day, is also a global pandemic, more than that perhaps, if we can find the right word. I want to make several points. I was going through your booklet that you have prepared, Seminar 2021, Book of Abstracts. You have covered some 19 topics. Several of those are extremely interesting. Even for a person like me who is a planner and not an architect, I want to highlight some of the things that relate to you as students and to us as teachers. I think this subject, the way it is taught, stands between theory and studios. It stands between the really interstices of theory and studios, the way we do it, both in architecture and in planning. The method is very unique. Your particular focus on research, I think coming from architecture makes a lot of sense. I'm sure you might have made a number of presentations before coming to this stage. Things are extremely important that you discuss here. And before I go any further, I want to highlight, perhaps you already are aware, speaking at the Conference of Parties, the Prime Minister at Glasgow, he spoke of five Amrit Tattva or Panch Amrit, and those are extremely important to achieving, even coming near to achieving the targets of climate change. He talked about zero net emissions by 2070, which is quite far away, but nonetheless, government made certain commitments. He also talked about enhancing non-fossil fuel energy capacity to 500 gigawatt by 2030, which is extremely important because buildings and cities play really a huge role in using energy, and through CO2. He talked about that we would achieve, India would achieve 50% energy needs through renewable energy sources. He further talked about that by 2030, India will bring down carbon intensity of its economy by more than 45%. I don't want to read all of those, but these are extremely important. But at the same time, UN Environment Program, in its latest report, is saying that carbon dioxide emissions have increased to 9.95 gigatons of carbon dioxide. And this is in 2019 report, and building sector accounts for nearly 40% of that. That means we really have to innovate as far as built environment is concerned. And several of you have pointed out that this is a major concern. So we might want to focus on decarbonizing the building sector itself. Green buildings, we have been discussing for now some time. I'm not sure what is the end result of this movement, but that movement should also intensify. I must say this. Before I stop, I don't want to take too much time. I just want to congratulate the students who have greatly contributed to preparation of this book of abstracts. I'm expecting, and our director is expecting, that this book of abstracts would be converted into a book where students would extend these abstracts and prepare scholarly papers, and school will be willing to help financially also to publish this book. Previously we have done this, and in future also we will continue to support this idea. Again, I want to congratulate the students and the studio coordinators. And I remember previously Professor Malai Chatterjee used to do this activity, supervise the students, and then later Professor Anjana Mittal started when she was part of the regular faculty here, and she continues to do so even after that. That is most welcome. And with these few words, I will stop here and wish you all the best. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, your kind words. We would now like to invite Professor Dr. Ranjana Mittal. We'd now like to request the head of the department of the Department of Architecture, Professor Dr. Anil Devan, to address the gathering.
Very good morning to all of you. Thank you, Professor Ashok Kumar, for your kind words. And we would definitely want to publish and bring out a publication out of the good work which the students have done. Their guides and the students have worked really hard, and it's a very, very it's a subject area which is very, very topical now. It's the theme of the season. So the sequence of the seminars is also very well organized. And what I want to say is that our department has been leading in its effort in this respect. So maybe since I talk about public health and I talk about indoor air quality and the air and water and all these things, but they are now so very important. And we've been working on these subjects much before the pandemic, and the pandemic has also given us a lot of opportunities in the way of our PhD scholars working on online mediums, on YouTube channels. And one of my PhD scholars, Raja Singh, has now a YouTube channel, The Built, where, and he's helping our students with this medium, and he is trying to take the architectural education to the masses. So I would request all of you to subscribe to that channel, to visit that channel, and to see whatever. So we are also now trying to bring our lectures online for everybody to access them. Since they're accessible to students online, we would like them to be open to all. Even this seminar, we have made it possible for more than 100 people to be here. Up to 250 people can join us, and we will do live streaming of this on YouTube channels also. So we want to make our programs accessible to others also because of this pandemic and these situations. With these few words, I would now hand it over to the organizers. Thank you very, very much for making this possible in these difficult times also. All the best to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. We would now like to invite Professor Dr. Ranjana Mittal, our seminar coordinator, to speak a few words about the seminar and introduce the jury.
Thank you.
Excuse me, ma'am. You can be on mute.
I'm very sorry. Thank you, Anne. Introduced me and to have pointed out that I was on silent. Okay. Good morning, Professor Ashok Kumar. Good morning, Professor Divan. Our jury for the day, Sambuddha Sen and Paka Guru. And all my one-time colleagues, Priyanka, and all the various students who've done a lot for this to come to, for the seminar program to come to this day. Gunjan Jain, my co-coordinator and the spine behind all of this, asked me to speak about the seminar program. And honestly, looking around, I realized that I was one of the only ones who could speak about it, since I am so much senior, so much older than all of you. The idea of the seminar was first brought about by Professor Molloy Chatterjee. I don't know how many of your students have even heard of him. Anyway, it was according to him another something like another dissertation in the syllabus almost 3 decades ago. And he converted it and he said, there's no point having 2 dissertations, one after the other. And he converted it into a group work wherein each group would collectively research a topic under the guidance of a faculty who would probably have initiated that topic in the first place. This, according to Professor Chatterjee, was going to help the students to understand, appreciate the goodness or the advantages of working in a group, and each one to practice public speaking. So each one of your group mates had to speak for the final presentation. So, and that was his idea of another kind of education. Each group also had a chance to be published as the papers we made were published, and all the papers that there were one or two always which were not selected for the publication, but this was published in the annual seminar book. So you could in your SOPs say that you were published, okay? And so it was that the summer holiday would be spent inviting faculty to submit their research proposals, somewhat like the electives that have invited these days. And these would be printed and put up on the notice board a little before school reopened for the odd semester. Students would get their preferred projects and guides in the first class of the semester. I remember one of the scenes where Professor Molloy Chatterjee put up all the, you know, in the third year, final year studio, third floor. He put up all the proposals at the end of the studio, huh? He printed them all and put them all up in the studio and said, now you read it and you decide what you want to do and come and tell me. The ones who come in first are the ones who get it. And that's how he used to do it. First come, first come. The first day, everything was done. Well, when he called me in to help him with the coordination, I changed it a bit and I followed some previous records, you know, academic records and things. And I tried to make it a little more specific, a little more fair, a little more less arbitrary. At that time, it was not even necessary for some proposals to be taken up, because if we had about 60 students, then we'd say, okay, 10 proposals, so we'd get about 12 or 15 proposals. So the students had a choice, and there were some which were not taken up at all. With the result, when the timetables were being made, nobody could be given a certain amount of the timings for the seminar. So regular faculty, especially, who were elected by the students, would do that out of their own interest and as an honor, because it was too late for them to be used and so that, you know, to be included in the timetable. Now it's very, 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 very strict with every faculty's hours, calculated and all that. Also, there was none of the very strict marking system we have now. Instead of a jury, the marks were given by the class, so each class had to attend every seminar, and the coordinator and the chairman might have, but the guide also. That way, each group was able to invite a chairman of their own choice. Okay. But then what happened was, we used to ask people to give us their topics, right?
So sometimes what happens, some people will say the same topic over and over again, and we've got some repetitions of the same kind of topic. So then we had to have a theme, and then we help the students create a topic, and then we help them, and then they chose their preferred guides, or we help them choose the guides who would be good for, or we thought would be good for their kind of presentation. This is what's happening today. A new syllabus about 5 years ago, I think, with Professor Manoj Mathur was head of department then, sensibly brought the seminars down to fourth year and pushed the dissertations up to final year, which means then you could practice research as a group and then do your own research in final year, which made a lot of sense to me at least. Initially, the seminar week in college was a very festive one, huh? Excuse me, please, I just have to tell my name. Go. I'm sorry. He hasn't learned anything yet about being polite. Done. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
So seminar week, the seminars used to be done during in the afternoon, 2 to 5. So all the seminars that we had were presented 2 to 5. Everyone was invited. So the other students were given an off in the afternoons to be able to attend these seminars. Okay. And then the Pramalay Chatterjee also suggested that you could dress up, you know. So all of the students in the seminars used to wear the same kind of clothes. They used to buy clothes.
That's so true, yes.
Sorry?
That's absolutely true, ma'am. We used to
used to buy clothes. And it was quite a festive occasion, you know, much to the annoyance of some of the practitioners who hated this and who used to, you know, hate the idea that so much time was being taken away from design studio because of this whole thing. And they used to really hate it. And I used to be worried that once Mala Chatterjee leaves, this thing will come down to nothing, but it did not. And so, of course, the past year we've had only to be able to, we haven't been able to have this week, this fashion week or this festival week in college. It has been online, but this year Gunjan has managed to do this and to make it to webinar, which would be nice, which would be available to make some kind of compensation for the seminar week in the audience in the college. This year, Gunjan has been able to get Professor Paul to agree to print our papers in the Space Journal also, which is very nice, which is really very nice. Other than the presentations, of course, which will be available online. So Professor Chatterjee, in spite of those practitioners who hated the time taken away from the design studio for some research, your baby has grown up and is alive and kicking, and this year has graduated into a webinar. This is what I was telling Molo yesterday, and I asked him to come, but he says he's quite useless online. And he will not be able to do it. So I might take the presentations to him and try and let him see them. So that's about it then. Let's hope we have a very good session today, as I think we will, because all the students are all ready and raring to go. So here we go. That's it for my...
Thank you so much, ma'am. We now welcome Architect Gunjan Jain, our seminar coordinator, to give the word of thanks.
Thank you, Joanne. Thank you, ma'am. It's very interesting to know the entire history of seminar from a faculty like who is associated with it from the very beginning of it. Thank you so much. So it's going to be a little long vote of thanks. Good morning, Professor Ashok Kumar, Professor Dr. Anil Devan, distinguished jury, guest invitees, fellow faculty members, and the students. On behalf of the seminar team,
it is a privilege for me to extend a vote of thanks to all those who have contributed in one way or the other for bringing the seminar to this eventful opening. First and the foremost, our sincere thanks to Dean Academics and the Acting Director, Professor Dr. Ashok Kumar, for inaugurating this two-day seminar program with his inspiring words. Your presence is a source of encouragement for the students and the faculty. Thank you, sir. A big thank you to HOD Architecture, Professor Dr. Anil Diwan, for his guidance and encouragement at every step. He has been extremely supportive in organizing the seminar jury as a series of webinars open to a wide audience and provided all the possible help and advice as required. Thank you so much, Diwan sir. We extend a very warm welcome to respected jury members, Mr. Sambuddha Sen and Ms. Anubha Kakru. Thank you for agreeing to be the jury of the day, and we look forward to your valuable feedback on the students' seminar research work. The satisfactory completion of the research work as per the defined scope has been possible due to the relentless support of the guides associated with the seminar team. Their guidance, regular inputs, and dedicated time with the students has been instrumental in refining the initial research proposals to the level wherein both the students and the seminar faculty are confident to share it on this platform. Three cheers to all the guides, Professor Anil Diwan, Professor Manoj Mathur, Professor Bandana Jha, Shubhajit Sarkar, Prabhjot Singh Sugga, Arpita Dayal, Priyanka Kochar, Sandeep Kumar, Gaurav Shori, Mr. Suneet Paul, and Kanishk Prasad for making this team work a great success. Thank you all the guides. Our gratitude to PhD scholar Ms. Priyanka Kochar for her valuable contribution in the discussions with the seminar groups. Thank you, Priyanka. We really appreciate the contribution of various resource persons for sharing their knowledge and expertise with the students, especially Dr. Leone Murinas, Architect Arpita Dayal, Architect Sandil Kapoor, Architect Dipendra Prasad, and Raja Singh. We owe a special thanks to Raja Singh for his technical help and guidance in organizing the seminar on this platform. Thank you so much, Raja. It is difficult to acknowledge all the names, so we would like to take this opportunity to thank each and every person who has contributed in any possible manner in the research work taken up by the students. Last but not the least, we would like to put on record our word of appreciation and thanks to all the students of fourth year batch for putting in their best with all the odds of an online semester. Literature was confined to whatever was available online, and surveys, wherever possible, also had to be done online. Still, during these difficult times, many groups managed to do field studies and interviews wherever it was possible. It was a challenge which most of you handled very well. We really appreciate the time and efforts put in by the editorial and design team. Ariman, Ashna, Harshita, Muskan, Priyanshu, Sahil, Sayantini, and Sadik in editing and putting the abstracts together and designing the posters. Technical team, Aman Raj, Arjun, Diljot Pal, Nishant, and Pratyush for putting the event on this platform. The publicity team, Ibrahim, Aditi, Azhar, and Tejasvi for spreading the word. And our Sutradhar team, Tilak, Ayushi, and Joanne, who will be taking us through a series of interesting webinars in these 2 days. A very big clap for all of them. All the seminar groups have given their best, and the coordination by the group leaders throughout the semester is worth mentioning. We congratulate the entire fourth year batch for bringing the seminar to the successful opening and taking it onto its logical end. Coordinating the batch of 120 students, dividing them in groups, assigning them research topics after thorough discussions, making them understand what is research, providing inputs to all the groups every week, coordinating with their guides for the marks and progress is anything but easy. On a personal note, I want to hug and thanks Professor Dr. Ranjana Mittal, my co-faculty, as a seminar coordinator. Later, who bestowed complete trust in me and has been a rock solid support with me. Love you, ma'am. Thank you, one and all. Now I would request our Sutradhar team to take the program forward and start with the presentations. Thank you and enjoy the presentations. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot. And now we would like to take this opportunity to present the rules we have for this seminar. Each presentation will be 20 minutes, followed by a 20-minute session for the jury feedback and questions from the audience. Everyone is requested to keep their cameras and mics off during the presentations. The audience is requested to post their questions in the Q&A forum. We'll show you how. Please do not interrupt during the presentation and wait till the end of the presentation to share any comments or feedback. We will illustrate right now how you could add the questions to the chat box. You could see an option here with this icon of a triangle, square, and a circle at your lower right-hand corner. And there's the third option is Q&A. You just need to click here and ask a question. Thank you. Joanne, I would like you to take over.
Yes, thank you so much, Tilak. We would now like to open today's theme, the pandemic, starting with the very first session, epidemics, grief, and healthcare. In these times of the pandemic, it is more important than ever to learn from our past, to plan for the future. As devastating as COVID-19 has been on us all, it is but a recent example of the various diseases that have plagued civilizations throughout history. Many elements of today's cities have been the result of past epidemics. When faced with one, cities in various parts of the world have responded by implementing new urban planning measures to curb the spread of an infectious disease, if not eradicated completely. With that, we would now like to welcome our very first group to shed some light on the subject through their topic, Cities Planned by Epidemics. Over to you.
Thank you, Joanne. Good morning, everyone. I'm Prableen Madan. Let me introduce you to my team members, Aryaman Kashyap, Diljot Pal Singh, Muskan Sandhu, Uday Pratap Gupta, and Shreya Singhal. Our guide for this research seminar is architect Sandeep Kumar. The dynamic relationship between contagious illness and the built environment has been a long and global story highlighted recently by the COVID-19 pandemic. We all recognize most of these iconic images, these straight, wide streets, green parks, underground sewer systems, and hard urban plazas that we know today were not just planned as urban interventions, but envisioned as measures to control outbreaks. These interventions were mostly driven by the idea that the design of the urban environment could physically remove sources of diseases and result in healthier inhabitants. When faced with an epidemic, cities in different parts of the world, having ample resources, have responded by building new infrastructure and implementing new urban planning measures to curb the spread of the infectious disease. We see that a lot of historical accounts demonstrate that there has been a dynamic intersection between illness and the built environment. Therefore, to deepen our understanding of the relationship between disease and urban form, we are trying to look at how cities and the discipline of urban planning have been impacted and informed by epidemics. tracing back to the 18th century, the Industrial Revolution was a major milestone in the history of human civilization, acting as a catalyst for the rapid development. This led to a sudden rise in employment and opportunities for working class labor in the then developing areas, which resulted in the rural population migrating to these cities. The capital available to house the growing population could not meet the demand posed by the rapid in-migration. Factory workers and low-income user groups were forced to reside in densely populated pockets in the cities. Factories generated waste, which would be dumped into the streets, ground, or poor sewer systems, eventually leading to contamination of water used by the people. These conditions resulted in repeated outbreaks of diseases. Epidemics are not new to humankind. They both have a long history together. Dating back to the 430 BC in Athens, multiple epidemics have had a devastating impact on human lives over centuries. Prior to industrialization, the death toll can be attributed to the underdevelopment of medical sciences, failing to counter the outbreak. Whereas post-industrialization, in search of opportunities, the populations in cities grew. These cities with dense settlements, lacking sanitation, despite improved medical guidance, facilitated the spread of contagious diseases. Our study consists of case studies from the past where cities saw significant changes in the urban form as a result of epidemics. Although these are grouped roughly by time for organizational purposes, we noted that there is always overlap and lag time between modes of thought, medical discoveries, and planning initiatives. Now, I'll hand over to Muskan and Diljotpal to take you through examples of such cities.
Thank you, Pavleen. For yellow fever of Philadelphia, with a population of approximately 55,000 in 1793, Philadelphia was America's largest city and its busiest port. It was hit with yellow fever in 1793, and that's what we'll be talking about first. The city of Philadelphia was laid out as a grid city by William Penn and Thomas Holmes, positioned between the two rivers, Delaware and Schuylkill, with its grid extending to each river. It played host to two active ports. The greatest density was near the ports along the Delaware River, and this was the prime reason for the spread of yellow fever from mosquitoes stored away on ships that came in from the Caribbean. The regions closest to the wharf with the highest population density were hit the hardest, especially the poor who could not afford to relocate from there. Approximately 10% of the population succumbed to yellow fever. Now, the measures that were taken by the state were, first, clearing out of the dense business and housing settlements closest to the wharf where the red zones were detected, then creating massive parks within each neighborhood to increase open public spaces for congregations, reducing the pollution of the rivers by dispensing neighboring settlements and bordering the riverfront with parks, setting up of an inspection and quarantine stations by the Philadelphia Board of Health. Now, these were located next to the port to quarantine sailors coming into the city, with adjacent burial grounds for the ones who had succumbed to the disease. And the last was bringing out innovations like sewerage and water filtration systems, which catered to the expanding urban density. Next, I'll be talking about London. Cholera hit London in 1831, 1848, and 1853, respectively. In 1831, the government hired Sir Edwin Chadwick, a social reformer, to carry out an inquiry into sanitation. The measures he introduced were based on the miasma theory, which attributed the spread of infectious diseases to foul-smelling air. He supported the rapid removal of human waste, seeing it as a major source of bad air that caused disease. His limited improvements to the chaotic sewage and drainage system led to a greater flow of raw sewage into River Thames, the main source of drinking water for London. By further contamination of London's water supply, the risk of cholera was increased. During this time, John Snow, a London-based physician, proposed that cholera was not transmitted by bad air, but by a waterborne infection. The studies by John Snow marked a milestone for countries throughout the world in the effort to curb the spread of cholera. It all started in London, where he investigated and traced some 600 cholera deaths occurring in a 10-day period, as we can see in the map. He observed that the cases either lived close to or were using the broad street pump for drinking water. Thus, he concluded that users of this pump became infected, and so the removal of its handle caused the epidemic to subside, as we can see in the graph. raw sewage continued to flow, overflow actually, into the River Thames, and in 1858 it caused the Great Stink. Based on the research of Dr. John Snow, Joseph Bazalgette arrived at the conclusion that major sewers needed to be designed across various points on the river so that sewerage and drinking water supply could be kept separate. In 1865, construction of a modern sewer system started that transported the city's waste and took it out to sea. While these main sewers and drainage tunnels may be hidden underground, the embankments along the side of the Thames are still there today. They also had additional benefits of providing London with new green spaces and riverside walkways, making the city greener and more livable. Cholera of New York. Cholera first hit New York City in June 1832. 3,000 New Yorkers died within weeks, while an estimated one-third of the city's 250,000 population fled. The disease hit the less wealthy sections of Manhattan, which were congested labyrinths of tenement housing, where poor sanitary conditions and crooked streets provided ample opportunity for people to come in contact with this disease. New York was becoming the new central hub that experienced high percentages of immigration from rural to urban, and this influx was catered by a then-introduced concept called tenement housing. These were basically buildings with few dwelling units each, and each of these units had just bare minimum physical space for a family to live. The provisions of light, ventilation, water, and sanitation were never the primary concern of the designs. Moreover, outside these houses, the streets themselves did not have proper sewage and drainage at the time, creating overflows and stinking stagnant pools, therefore adding to the problem. Hence, when these congested spaces became infected, there was an outbreak. This is when dumbbell housing was introduced to ensure proper light and ventilation in the dwelling units. Moreover, to improve the overall living conditions of the city, a new water supply system, that is the Croton Aqueduct, was made subsequently to help in reconfiguring the drainage system as well. A reservoir was later turned into a water body around which a huge central park was constructed to improve the city's air quality and create open spaces for the residents. Now I'll hand it over to Diljot, who will talk about Paris and Bombay.
Thank you, Muskan. Next, I'll talk about cholera outbreak in Paris in 1848 that took the lives of close to 19,000 people. This was the same time around which cholera also hit London and New York, and similar efforts to curb the outbreak by introducing sanitary measures were being taken. Paris's earlier sewer system that was built in the 1200s consisted of open troughs that ran down the center of each cobblestone road. It was not very effective and contributed to the spread of diseases such as the Black Death. In 1370, the first underground sewer was built and sewers were expanded slowly throughout the next 400 years. However, due to the lack of coverage beneath the city and widespread disrepair, the sewers remained a problem for the city. In 1805, a man called Bruneseau was commissioned to undertake the building of 182 new miles of underground sewer. Taking inspiration from London, new and bigger sewers called Les Égouts began to be constructed in the 1840s and 1890s. They were designed by Eugene Belgrand. The construction of these newer, larger systems started in 1850 on borrowed money. Baron Haussmann and Eugene Belgrand engineered separate underground passages for drinking water and sewage using iron piping and digging techniques, which was made possible by the Industrial Revolution. By 1870, over 500 kilometers of new sewers were either in service or under construction. By 1878, the sewer system was over 600 kilometers long. The map shows the new streets introduced by Haussmann in Paris, which were mirrored underground in forms of sewers. By 1930, the entire system was finished, one sewer for each street. This sanitation campaign formed the basis of the urban landscape we know today. Paris's sewer system overhaul presented an opportunity to build Haussmann's grand boulevards that we see today. The next city I'm talking about is Bombay. The bubonic plague of Bombay was a part of the epidemic which originated in China during the 1850s and traveled across to India by the end of 1890s. The main carrier of the disease was identified as the wild rats carried infected fleas. The thatched roof tenements known as chawls were the hotspot for these rodents. As a result, the disease spread dramatically. Poor sanitary and even worse drainage conditions added to the spread of the virus. There were several other policies and laws passed by the government which were supposed to curb the spread and also provide relief to the people, but failed to perform as projected. Even though the authorities tried to disinfect the houses and sweep with force, it was not quite practical to completely eradicate the bacteria which was deep-rooted in the depths of these housing units. The Epidemic Diseases Act of 1897 allowed inspection of any traveler or any mode of travel to detain and segregate plague suspects. By the end of 1898, Bombay Mill Owners Association, in coalition with the government, formed the Bombay Improvement Trust, which was aimed at providing living conditions, which was aimed at improving living conditions for the slums. Instead of building new homes, BIT worked as a slum clearance board, worsening the already worse housing crisis. A decade after the plague, the policies for new homes for the mill workers slowly gave into privatization under the market-oriented approach and were almost negligible. Now, I'll hand it over to Uday, which he'll talk about the urban planning measures.
Thank you, Diljot. Today, urban density is popularly believed to be the major contributor to spread of infectious diseases in cities. While density might increase the rate of contact for human-to-human transmissible disease, other factors such as poor sanitation take precedence when considering diseases of a different nature. There are various urban planning strategies that cities have implemented to curb epidemics. We look at what measures various cities took and what were the similarities between their environments and how it impacted modern-day urban planning. This helped us understand the measures in a systematic way and led us to categorize them in a few broader heads. Sewage. Sarah Jensen Carr emphasizes that the grid planning system in the United States during cholera primarily focused at improving sewerage and drainage systems, as long streets allowed long straight pipes to be laid under the roads, facilitating unhampered sewage flow. Moreover, in London, a new drainage system was designed, shutting down the connection of sewer drains to the River Thames. The project was completed in 1870 and had 132 kilometers long sewers connecting strategic locations. This forms the heart of the present London sewerage system. The long time of construction, which was undertaken in phases, helped the authorities to design and experiment numerous sewer sections, solving a problem with every subsequent design. The underground sewer and tunnel system laid in such cities formed the foundation for the genesis and expansion of the modern day sewerage system and street layout. Garbage collection. Karen Nikos Rose attributes the inception of garbage disposal system in Philadelphia to the yellow fever of 1790s, which she says transformed urban planning by giving rise to municipal garbage services and sanitation departments in cities. Garbage removal can also be seen as a driving factor in the formulation of the new Tenement Act 1901 in New York, whose main purpose was to close loopholes in the previous laws, one of which was the accumulation of garbage in the shafts. This was controlled with the additional requirement of courtyards and alleyways in all the tenement housings, which can still be seen in many American cities. Open spaces. During the 1890s, theorists like Frederick Law Olmsted generalized slum conditions seen in working-class neighborhoods as a root cause of disease, amplified through density, resulting in mass contagion. Olmsted believed that increasing open space is a solution to the contagion. Hence, his intervention in 1925, the Central Park in New York, elevated the density and improved the living conditions in the city. Early examples of authorities attempting to provide open spaces to Central Parks can be seen in Philadelphia too, where the central burial ground used during the yellow fever was converted into a public park now known as the Washington Square. Creating public parks was not the only method adopted to provide openness. Many cities took upon the massive task of demolition for widening the streets. Starting with Paris, Haussmann's plan directed demolition of thousands of houses for building wide tree-lined boulevards. Even in India, Bombay Improvement Trust tried a similar strategy. They had to open out crowded localities by demolition of old tenements. The new building bylaws, when enforced, ended up creating chaos among the owners of the tenements. Although these were logical on measures on paper and even proven successful in other cities, it just could not be implemented in Bombay. Housing. This rapid and careless construction of tenements became the breeding ground for numerous diseases in various cities. New York and Bombay are two major examples where initially tenement housing had no regulations and had no thought about the tenants and their basic necessities such as lighting and ventilation. This is when New York authorities started introducing tenement laws, which led to dumble housing. They were built in great numbers in order to accommodate waves of immigrating Europeans. The New York State Tenement House Act of 1901 was one of the first such laws to ban the construction of dark and poorly ventilated tenement buildings. Among other sanctions, the law required that new buildings must be built with indoor toilets and fire safeguards. This continuous evaluation and development has helped us reach the quality of affordable housing we have today with proper ventilation and sanitation. Similarly, in Bombay, the root cause behind the spread of plague was directly linked to the tightly packed community tenements or chawls. The insanitary and poor drainage conditions of the tenements of Mandvi and Dharavi emerged to be the primary focus of all the authorities. This has changed how the authorities further developed these areas. The courtyard system in chawls we see now, which still might seem inadequate, has come a long way from where it started. Zoning. The rich in the past have blamed a specific class of people for the spread of a disease, leading to geographical segregation of different groups of people based on class or economic conditions. The plague of 1914 in Senegal resulted in a 9-meter wide road separating the upper and lower class, which stays intact till date. This segregation in various cities has resulted in an apparent zoning based on class, which can still be seen in these cities. Squalor settlements near factories and water bodies turned out to be fatal in many earlier cases, since the main water source used to be contaminated by the sewage and factories, which created a lot of pollution as well. This is why authorities started segregating functions so as to avoid the formation of squalor settlements, which could cause an outbreak. Animals like cattle, chicken, and pigs were driven from port and railway stations to markets throughout the cities. Authorities made restrictions on animals' movement within the city to avoid littering all over the place. This determined locations for the shortage activities. Although enforcement of the regulations proceeded slowly, these laws grew up to play a vital role in the regulatory and administrative basis of urban planning and allied professions. Besides immediate effects which pandemics had, there were some larger issues which they solved in the long run. Zoning based on street widths, heights, and setbacks may not be a direct result, but can be seen as a byproduct of what was realized during the epidemics. Now, I'll invite Aryaman to conclude his presentation by relating our study to the present scenario.
Thank you, Uday. The similarities of the epidemics that we studied lie at the causal factor as well as the measures taken to control the spread. We can notice that most of the diseases were spread owing to poor drainage and insanitary conditions in the densely packed areas, which, as a result of industrialization and excessive migration, house the disease-carrying agents. Measures taken to curb the spread of disease, like lighting and ventilation policies, decongestion of cities by widening the streets and creating parks, and implementing proper sanitary and drainage facilities at micro and macro level, all factored in shaping up the cities in which the disease occurred. Thus, the effective measures opted by the regions facing these epidemics reflect upon the strategy of adopting urban planning policies from these regions that suffered from a similar outbreak in the past. Although this adoption did not prove to be successful all the time, it surely provides lessons for incorporating something indigenous. When populations are packed tightly into urban areas, they come in contact more often and thus have more opportunities to spread disease. This intuition coincides with our standard understanding of the spread of infectious diseases, but it is only partly true for present conditions of COVID-19. As per the analysis by American professors Jason Barr and Troy Dazier, density does positively relate to the number of current cases, but the effect is relatively small. Here, globalization may be considered the key factor that dictates the spread of COVID-19 in today's world. The cities that have been infected most may seem to be the ones with higher population densities, but they are also commercial hubs with a large influx of tourism and business travel. The biggest shifts our cities might experience after the pandemic have already been taking shape. It is factors like climate change and non-communicable epidemics that have been crucial for planners and architects in the current scenario for a while now. The current pandemic is accelerating these efforts, turning proposed changes like expanded bike lanes, more walkable city districts, and smart buildings from computer simulations into real-world experiments. Thus, the pandemic that has gripped the world for almost 2 years now will not fabricate the built. Rather, it will change the way we interact with the built environment that already exists. Thank you.
Thank you so much, team, for that informative presentation. We now request the jury to give their feedback on the presentation and for the audience to post their questions in the Q&A forum.
Can I get Anubha, would you like to start?
No, why don't you start? I just had one question though from Joanne. Is that do we just have to give feedback or can we question also?
Ma'am, you can give them questions and as well as feedback.
Thanks a lot. I think it's a wonderful presentation in the sense that it puts things in perspective from the point of view of built environment and how to mitigate the problems of things like epidemics and things like that. But I have a couple of, I think it's largely, I agree to what has been said, but two, three things that I have. One is that the importance of water bodies and rivers in our life, especially in India. So all the cities were built along the rivers, right? And that used to be the source of everything that we had. I mean, drinking water, washing, everything used to happen along the banks of the river. Now what happened was that the sewer system was introduced. Now what happened was that the river became the kind of a sewer channel again, because everything was being now routed back to the river. It stopped supporting life. It became a drain. Now this is what had happened was that, you know, what was happening that we are making waste travel hundreds of kilometers just to reach the point of release in the river, and we're eventually polluting the river. So that's a lot of people hold this view that the whole problem started because we stopped treating sewage locally. So what is happening was that we are making sewage travel all the way hundreds of kilometers to a sewage treatment site and then onto the river or some water body, and in turn we are kind of polluting everything, which I mean, you can see what's happened to the Ganges in Varanasi and other towns. So this is one of the points. And there's an interesting thing that they've done in Korea, that they've turned back one of these rivers into a very fine urban space, where they have stopped the sewage from going to the river, and they've turned that into a wonderful riverside park and all that. That's one. The other point I had to make was that, you know, for example, you have quoted the example of Paris, for example, that how it they thought that Baron Haussmann would his plan would kind of help to mitigate the problems of you know, epidemics and all that. But it was not all kind of dictated by a concern for Paris. There was something more. I think you must have read about it. They wanted to control a number of insurrections and revolutions that were happening every day. Paris was a very troublesome place, and it was very difficult to control because the lanes were narrow, and it was very difficult for the army or the police to get in. So they wanted large boulevards to move the artillery. So one of the biggest criticisms of Paris plan is this. I mean, there's no doubt. I mean, it's a lot of things improved. There is a lovely boulevards and green spaces and all that, but at the same time, it kind of ruined the whole saying, you know, the fabric of old Paris. So though it's true that they tried to sell this whole scheme as a measure to control epidemic and improve the hygiene. That's one. I think that's about all I have to say, but I think it's a wonderful presentation, and good going.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Samrudha, also for kind of paraphrasing it so well. I actually have a lot of issues with the presentation. It's a very well thought out and researched presentation, but I find it's... that could be because of the history of urban planning has been Eurocentric. So yeah. I find the whole presentation to be extremely Eurocentric in its study and in its historicity.
I agree.
It didn't really take into account, I mean, 70 years down the line from 75 years now down the line from independence, and a good, I think, 100 odd years down the line when we started talking of Swadeshi, I think we could have done with a little bit more. I'm not saying it has to be Indo-centric, but it could definitely be more Asian
in its outlook and look at how the situation has been kind of dealt with in traditionally, and traditional doesn't always have to be old-fashioned. I would say a traditional knowledge system has much to give as well. You did mention Bombay, but Bombay is a colonial example. So I'm talking of a non-colonial intervention, how that has happened. One of the issues that I have with a traditional urban planning approach is that it is designed for sewage disposal, essentially, and which is what you also stated. And that means that the urban planning becomes, or the morphology is a straight line morphology, because waste and water will travel the best when the pipes are straight. Yeah, that's basic physics, right? But what happens is in that process, we completely ignore the topography to a very large extent. And therefore, when we talk today of sustainability and unsustainability, most of our towns anywhere in the world are unsustainable because we are not in keeping with the natural undulations or topography or climate of the land. Everything is made human-centric, and I have a great problem with the word human-centric. While human-centric design may be something that everybody talks about, but I think the problem with the world is that everything is human-centric. It needn't be. Why is everything made so convenient for the human beings at the expense of everybody and everything else? So this would have been a good opportunity for the young students who are going to be practicing soon or intervening in the physical and built environments to look at absolutely turning the systems of planning on its head and see how you don't have to be making everything so easy for the human beings. Because essentially what we've done is by making everything easy for the human beings is that we've sacrificed everything else in the natural world, whether that's a living or the non-living resource, or whether that's any creature or any other mineral or whatever. So human-centered design is a problematic concept for me. I would have really liked if you had looked at alternatives or even historical examples where it is not always human-centric. So the bottom line is the sustainability and capacity versus convenience. Most of urban planning norms that we see today are around the convenience of the human population, and that to the urban human population. And that itself is something that could be questioned. The pandemic has given us a good breather or a good warning, whichever way you want to look at it, to relook at these systems. Must we have today in a post-industrialist world, must we have solid, strong urban congregations? And while I do admire the Central Park in New York and all of that, but do remember that it's all conditioning. We have grown to like wide avenues and central parks, while they may not be something that necessarily work in an Indian situation. We may not. Our cities are made for vehicles and automobiles, and that's an American concept, and it's not necessarily needed or may not, or it's high time we kind of questioned it. Another thing that I said, when you mentioned, is that the choles are problematic. Sure, the choles are dense environment, but what about the quality of life? What about living systems that a chole provides, as opposed to the so-called affordable housing? And we know enough about the disasters of affordable housing, whether that is in India or anywhere in the world. The very famous example, of course, being the Pruitt housing, which had to be demolished because of the way it did not acknowledge and acknowledge and admire in a way the living systems of communities. So choles have, and Dharavi also has, extremely wonderful living systems and communities. I'm sure they have problems, but then to say that the problems comes from these morphologies is something which I find problematic. As the 21st century or the post-industrial urban designers, architects, and planners, we probably ought to think about systems which are not yet 100 years old. The systems that we were discussing here is something which developed after industrialization, that is in the late 19th or the mid-19th century. We are 2 centuries past that, and I think it's time that we rethought it. So while this was a very comprehensive document on how urban planning has evolved, it left me a little wanting in terms of what it could be or what it should be in the given context, given the way the climate is, given the way our context, local context, South Asian context is, and the way economy or economic systems are developing. So I think that aspect of how post-epidemic or post-pandemic urban planning or planning per se could have been is something that I wish you had touched upon. And I would invite your comments or defense to this if anybody wants to add to that. Sorry, that was a long tirade. I'm sorry.
Thank you, ma'am, for your reply.
Like, ma'am, to touch upon the more Indian context, we took upon a Indian case study like the Surat, the plague in Surat, but we didn't elaborate much on Surat since it was a very immediate response and they didn't much took upon many urban planning measures. It was more of a municipal measure which is undertook, like increasing the efficiency of garbage services. So we didn't much elaborate on that.
But urban planning or urban systems or urban built environment should not just be planning, right? It is systems. So the idea is to move beyond thinking planning, and you have to start thinking of systems. And they all work together, whether it's municipal systems, community systems, natural systems, or planning systems.
No, we could have gone further than built form.
Thinking is an approach that probably needs to come in.
And also for predicting what could have been the future developments in urban planning from the COVID, we thought that we are not expert in the field, so we couldn't predict that much accurately, so we left it with an open-ended question.
It's all right. You should always take a leap of faith. If not now, then when? If not you, then who? But I think Sambuddha wants to say something.
I think one of the trends that has become kind of popular now, or I think it makes sense now, is that you treat, for example, sewage locally. I mean, as much as possible. Don't let it travel hundreds of kilometers to some place and pollute this place further. So this is becoming a major, I think, in future, this sewage will be largely treated locally, I think. But that too has this problem. For example, in a place like Dubai, what's happened is, because of the nature of the soil, they cannot have a very, they cannot run sewer lines properly. So what they have done is they have created this huge tanks where sewage is collected. And then in the evening, the trucks come and fill them up. Now, there's a huge queue in the evenings to clear those tanks. And some unscrupulous people, what they've done is they've started releasing this muck in the sand itself. So it has found its way to the sea and the beach. So these problems are kind of inherent in, you know, all the systems. But I think, and in many cities, you know, I lived in Iran for many years. So they didn't have a sewage system. A huge city like Tehran didn't have a sewage system. It was surprising. I mean, we were surprised to know when you reach that there is no sewage system in the city. You simply had a, around the toilets, there would be some kind of shaft and things would be let down to the, there's a pit, that's it. Because the earth, the quality of earth is very dry and powdery. So it has also been shown that, you know, this, the sewage kind of, and, if it has less water, it can be processed very fast. It turns into dust very soon. It doesn't stay there for long. So these are some of the things one has to really look at. And the processing of sewage has become, I think, a major issue these days. You can see what's happening now. Look at what happened during Chhat at Noida. What has happened? Largely because of all these problems, we are leading everything to the riverfront. That's a problem. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir and ma'am, for your comments and your feedback. I would now like to hand over the stage to Tilak to take in the next presentation.
Moving on to our next topic, grief during pandemic. The next group draws attention on the fact that in today's cities, mental health is as important as physical health. And indeed, the pandemic is the most recent incident which showed us how situations like these can create a sense of fear and trauma in the people who are sick as well as the healthy. With that, let us see what they have to say on this sensitive topic. We invite the group to start the presentation.
Good Good morning, everyone. I am Muskan Rampal, and with me, I have Deepak Jangir, Hardik Mittal, Sahil Jain, and Swati Suman as my teammates, and our respected guide is architect Gunjan Jain, who mentored us throughout the research titled Grief During Pandemic.
An ancient ritual performed by a 13-year-old schoolboy. Today, Rudra Sonthalia had to summon all his courage to say farewell to his father.
मतलब पापा को लास्ट टाइम में वीडियो कॉल पे देखा था तभी पापा हॉस्पिटल में थे एडमिट तब पापा को लास्ट टाइम देखा फिर अगले दिन जब वो पास हो गए
बहुत हैप्पी फैमिली थे मम्मी का जब हुआ था तो पापा की चिंता थी कि पापा को बचाना है जब पापा को हुआ तो घर में बच्चे अकेले हैं तो पास ऑन होता जा रहा है कि अब ये है कि बच्चों को कैसे आगे बढ़ाना
अब लड़के को मार गया 25 साल का लड़का था मेरा बेटा एक ही औलाद मेरे थी भैया मेरे आगे इनका शाम को
This is not a one-time problem, as many more such waves and pandemics are expected in the near future. Thus, there is a need to deal with complications related to prolonged grief, mental health issues, and death in an empathic and sustainable manner. Through our research, we aim to understand grief during pandemic and find answer to the question, what can be done to help people cope up with grief in pandemic through sensitive rethinking of spaces?
To structure our research, we define the following objectives. We begin with understanding grief and its various physical and mental impacts. Next, we learn how grief is affected by different people differently based on several parameters. What are the differences in experienced grief during pandemic in comparison of normal times? The next objective was to understand how pandemics and epidemics were dealt in history to draw parallels between the past to get recommendations on how to deal it in future. The last objective was to come up with strategies that help us cope up with grief now and in future pandemics. Hardik would now explain to us what is grief and how it influences people.
Grief, most commonly associated with death, is a response to loss, usually the loss of someone or something that the sufferer shared a bond with. In some cases, it could lead to prolonged periods of sadness, depression, and isolation. While the grieving process is quite unpleasant, it is very important to fully accept the loss and get back to a normal life. Guilt, anger, and confusion are very strongly associated with grief and the different ways through which people express it. Toddlers express it through play and drawing. Older children do the same by aggression, tantrums, stomach aches, and changes in sleep patterns. Adolescents get quite restricted about grief and can't have a proper conversation if not given a chance. Older people sometimes suppress grief, which could come out as irrational anger. Although eventually people learn to live and grow with grief, it never fully leaves and becomes a part of their life. Now, Deepak would talk about a few models of grief.
The models of grief that we have studied are the Kubler-Ross model, 4 tasks of grieving, 6 hours of mourning, and the dual process model. Kubler-Ross model talks about the 5 different emotional stages that a person goes through while experiencing grief. It usually starts at denial, with stages of anger, bargaining, and depression following through. These stages do not necessarily follow an order and sometimes one or more of these stages don't even occur. The later stage is acceptance of the loss, usually in a positive way. The four tasks of grieving model takes an active approach to the grieving process and lays out certain hurdles for the grieving person to conquer. Task 1. The reality of the loss has to be accepted and acknowledged. Task 2. The feeling has to be processed and thought through rather than ignored. Task 3. Some adjustments have to be made in order to live with the loss. Task 4. Rather than forgetting the loved one, a mental connection should be established. 6 hours of mourning model is quite similar to the previous model. It puts towards an active grieving process where one needs to move from the stage of avoidance of emotion to the accommodation of loss through a stage of confrontation, which involves processing of the feelings of grief. The dual process model is quite different from the others. It says that after the loss of a loved one, all the activities and thought of the person fall under two categories: loss oriented, with a focus towards the painful emotions, and the restoration oriented, with a distraction from the painful emotions. The grieving process happens through oscillation between these two stages, which could occur multiple times in a day. Now I would like to call Hardik for comparing these grief models and to talk about structure derived from it.
So all the models had outlined the basic timeline of a grieving process, starting at a stage of negative feelings, going through a mid stage of some kind of coping or processing of grief, and ending at some sort of acceptance and adjustment to the changed life. The most striking difference in these models was the formulation of
the grieving process either as a set of passive occurrences or a set of active tasks. In the Kubler-Ross model, the emotional stages usually happen and the sufferer goes through them. While the four tasks of the grieving model, those tasks have to be done to complete the grieving process properly. While these models do give away a good way to think about grief and explain the behavior of grieving people, there is a general criticism that they make the idea of grief very rigid and don't account for individual differences. We need to understand that grief is a very personal experience and varies from person to person. Keeping these differences in mind, we have devised a structure to account for individual experience of grief. Hardik?
Yeah. All the characteristics and situations of the person, which cannot be changed significantly at will, are static factors. All the traits of a person, which can either be changed at will or through the help of others in a short span of time, are dynamic factors. We have the personality traits of a person, like extroversion, openness to experience, identity traits like age, gender, religion, etc., and bonding with the lost loved one as static factors. In dynamic factors, we have the current state of mind, which changes constantly, mental and physical health, and the support group and environment. Although segregated, these factors are very much interconnected and can impact each other. Now, I would like to invite Muskan to continue with the primary site study.
Delhi, the national capital, is not only one of the most populous cities of India, but was also one of the prime hotspots during COVID-19. To have an understanding of on-ground reality, we looked into number of deaths and number of confirmed cases of different zones in Delhi, where the southwest zone was selected as it had the highest number of deaths and the highest number of positive cases overall in all age groups. In the zone itself, two areas were identified, namely Dwarka and Nazafgarh. On further exploration and discourse, the highlighted zone with the residential area accommodating LIG, MIG and HIG housing, private hospital, government dispensary, a Hindu cremation ground, a Christian cemetery, and a Muslim graveyard was identified. Several interviews were conducted with residents, doctors, ambulance workers, and crematorium workers to understand the mental and physical problems faced by different strata of people. However, to maintain the anonymity of resource persons, their name has not been revealed through the research. Data from certain high-density regions, such as Nazafgarh, that were not approachable due to COVID restrictions and limitations, were collected through online survey forms. The form was circulated nationally, where we got 350 plus responses from different states across different age groups. On the basis of survey, literature, and primary study, we categorized the sufferers into three categories on the basis of relation with the deceased or the occupant of the sufferer. These are active sufferers, passive sufferers, and frontline workers. Active sufferers are the ones who faced personal loss in and around their houses. Passive sufferers are the ones who didn't face any personal loss but were affected and impacted by large number of deaths. Frontline workers are the medical and the paramedical staff, ambulance drivers, crematorium workers, etc., who put their lives on stake to contain the virus. The study, however, will not be able to help much with people suffering from critical complications, including death due to COVID. Active sufferers. The ones which were directly exposed to death and grief are active sufferers. Even though death is not a new concept, the unconventional grieving process in a situation of confinement, lack of ability to provide support to those who are suffering, or to perform rituals according to our traditions and customs, made the process all the more difficult. All this was exaggerated by lack of medical facilities, such as oxygen cylinders, hospital beds, which created a lot of havoc and fear. According to the survey conducted, 38% respondents lost their loved ones, out of which we discovered that only 17% were able to follow all the traditions and customs, and almost for 20% of the sufferers, none of the family members could attend the last rites. All this resulted in 47% people having anxiety and restlessness, and 42% having mental stress and depression. One of the active sufferers we interviewed still gets nightmares of his mother breathing her last in his arms. The fact that he had to drag the body alone on the road as the rest of the family members were positive was really heart-wrenching for him as well as for us, listening to him talk when he broke down crying. Now, I would like to invite Sahil to throw light on the problems faced by passive sufferers and frontline workers.
Thank you, Muskan. Now, talking about the passive sufferers, that is, the people who didn't face any personal loss and are only affected by hearing the loss. This category of people usually face problems such as physical inactivity, inability to see friends due to COVID restrictions, and increased screen time, etc. After analyzing the responses age-wise, it was found that people between the age 14 to 30 usually craved for social interaction and had a desire for new experiences. Since they were restricted to stay at home and they had no place to focus their energy on, this age group suffered the most mentally during the pandemic. Survey results indicated that 44% of people faced fear and anxiety, 66% experienced social isolation, and 50% of them felt depressed and experienced insomnia. For the age group of 30 to 45, the problems varied from income losses to some domestic violence cases also. Survey showed that although 50% of people experienced fear, anxiety, and social isolation, this age group could cope up in the lockdown in a better way, with 27% of people having no mental problems as such. The percentage of mental health cases further decreased to about 31% of people having no problem in the age group of 45 plus. They usually face problems coping with the digital technology and lack of natural interactive spaces for them, and almost 40% of them experience fear and anxiety. Apart from age group, gender is another major factor. The challenges faced by women are usually complex and interrelated. These challenges also intersect with age, economic class, religion, etc. And yet, one thing is clear, negative impacts are disproportionate for women. Economic problems included higher rates of job losses, greater burden of domestic and care work, and healthcare workers, which were usually at a higher risk constantly, had about 70% females. There are spikes in sexual, physical, and domestic violence and exploitation too. During these difficult times, the real heroes, frontline workers, while serving for the people, also faced severe mental health issues. Biggest of the problems for doctors was to be in the dilemma of prioritizing patients to treat first or even save lives sometimes. There were problems regarding social stigma, overworking, and no clear communication with superior. When asked by a doctor about the conditions of the hospital, He mentioned that the staff was limited with critical cases coming every minute. It was physically and mentally exhaustive for all the healthcare workers. One of the pandits in the crematorium in Dwarka told how the numbers changed from 1 to 2 to 70 bodies per day, and they hardly got to sleep for 3 to 4 hours and to eat. He also mentioned that Christian bodies were also coming this time as the places were full to bury. During the conversation with ambulance driver, he mentioned how they had to be on duty and not able to sleep for consecutive days. The government dispensaries were also closed at this time, which could have been used to accommodate more patients. While the pandemic brought a lot of new challenges for everyone, there is a history of pandemic which can help in coming up with solutions and interventions. Continuing about the same, I would like to ask my colleague Swati Suman to begin.
We conducted a review of literature and formed a timeline of the past pandemics and epidemics to see how people dealt with it back then and looked for consistent seasonal patterns. In Athenian plague, the doctors were affected in high numbers and the pandemic claimed life up to 25% of the population. In Antonine plague, led to renewal of spirituality and religiousness. It destroys as much as 1/3 of the population in some areas. The Justinian plague took lives of many, and those individuals who did survive infection usually had to live with prolonged after effects and stigmata of survivors. Because the grave sites were filled beyond capacities, within a short time, the bodies of the victim were thrown on the streets or pulled along the seashore to rot. Huge pits were dug and the corpses were collected in them. Soon they overflowed and the bodies were then placed inside the towers in the wall. The Black Death killed as many as 150 million people over a century. Entire neighborhoods, sometimes entire towns, were wiped out or settlements abandoned. Crops could not be harvested, traveling and trade become curtailed, food and manufactured goods become short. The Spanish flu pandemic killed more individuals in an year than the Black Death had killed in a century. These pandemics usually tended to affect mostly young and previously healthy individuals. In HIV, we could induce how depression in individuals shows association with substance abuse, and that issue of stigma, guilt, and shame affects the outlook for HIV patients, including their own adherence to life-saving treatment. SARS and swine flu in the 21st century resulted in some valuable data studying and analyzing the mental health aspects of the outbreak. It was among the first outbreaks where policy reports included mental health as an aspect of preparedness and mitigation policy efforts. Based on the study of policies and reports, we were able to find few interventions for the situation, which included strategies to address mental health issues and important measures to be taken during crisis on neighborhood level, with increasing state and local efforts and planning. In many cases, community involvement played a huge role, and it was done by supervision by a specific community. Awareness and messages were spread over regular announcements. Young people in the community were encouraged to work and take part in group activities. Real-time consultations were accompanied by mental and behavioral health specialists to provide technical assistance and guidance, focusing on the needs of individuals with pre-existing mental problems and attention to special populations. In order to be ready for such circumstances in future, preparedness in respect to educational materials in the area of disaster mental health and material for all hazard and public health emergencies were sorted out beforehand. Now Muskan and Sahil will provide some recommendations for the study.
For our chosen zone, a prototype was created which would implement the above recommendations. There were two departments: mental health and disaster management. Both the department would consist of a trainers and awareness team with the trained school teachers and some permanent members, as well as a temporary team of volunteers to help them out. Mental health team would also consist of a professional team of one psychologist and one physician working together to identify patients, while the disaster team would consist of managing team tasked with preparing a team of frontline workers for the future disasters or pandemics. The team of one psychologist and one physician would work together to identify patients who may not be willing to come out. Apart from personal consultations, there would be general talks about mental health by the psychologist so that people unwilling to seek medical help individually can benefit, while also raising general awareness in the process. Awareness about the complexity of the grieving process needs to be raised so that people are better equipped to deal with it. Volunteers would maintain local self-help groups, which are especially important for a metropolitan area where people do not know their neighbors very well. It could help with reducing isolation, which is a significant problem during the grieving period. And understanding that the pandemics could occur again, there should be a disaster management team in place, which would consist of a frontline worker management team, as well as a trainers and an awareness team, which would conduct drills for evacuation, masks and oxygen cylinder usage protocols, and train volunteers for the future disaster situations. Now, I would like to invite Muskan to discuss the architectural recommendations.
Mixed-use development and vertical mixing of compatible uses within plots shall be promoted in the city, facilitating availability of all services, work centers, and homes within close vicinity of each other, facilitating self-sufficient isolation zones. Development of large green areas and reducing build densities through planned regeneration will support requirements of social distancing during pandemics while providing an active public realm during normal times. These spaces could further be utilized as refuge spots, common kitchens, quarantine spaces, etc. at the time of emergency. The creation of multi-facility plots that can be used temporarily, repurposed along with other government facilities during the time of disaster should be mandated. For instance, small clinics and dispensaries that remained unused during the peak could be utilized for providing refuge spots and disaster management shelters. Housing typology. Since most of the people were confined to their houses, the need for a good housing design arose. Sanitation and isolation zones to be maintained at the entrance as buffers. Greens, instead of having a central green, pockets, distributed pockets with varied functions to be used. Natural light and ventilation for all rooms in the dwelling unit should be compulsory. Community spaces should be distributed into various zones such as greens on the ground floor and raised greens to accommodate parking. Community spaces with general talks and meetings, remembrance meetings can happen, should be incorporated as part of design. Also, terraces could be used as meditation and community spaces. To conclude, the study proposes exchanging experiences and support within smaller community groups at neighborhood level, creating general awareness about mental health and its related issues, promoting mixed-use development to mobilize internal resources to deal with grief of this magnitude while containing the spread. Thank you.
Thank you, team. That was a very insightful presentation. We now invite the jurors to give their comments and raise their questions, and the audience to post their questions in the Q&A forum. Sir, you're on mute.
Okay. Anubha, can you take on right now?
Yeah. Sure.
Please go ahead.
Thank you. Of course, whatever you said is true, and it is something that happened, especially in Delhi. We've all sort of seen it from various angles. What I really want to understand is that as a documentation, sure, but as an architect or as a space designer or a space planner, what is it that you propose or that we can do which can alleviate grief? Yes, there was the last slide where you did speak about, you know, a kind of a neighborhood which is self-sustaining, and you did take Dwarka as an example, which on the whole is on that neighborhood concept. So all neighborhoods in Dwarka are anyway self-sustaining, right? Even right now, it is a low density area in any case. It's very, very low density. It really is not LIG from whatever little I've seen of it. Dwarka is primarily MIG and HIG, except for a couple of urban villages that are there. So how would you, you said that your area was South Delhi and some of the things that you mentioned. How would that pan out in a situation, let's say I'm not even trying to go to a very complex area, but let's say something like Malviya Nagar, if you're familiar with that, which is definitely a higher density area and it exists. Now, you know, all the proposals that you mentioned they can be implemented there, but they'll be tougher because it is high density. It's higher density. Dwarka actually is a very, very, if I may use the word, very luxurious development in a city like Delhi. It is extremely sparse and it could be very easily contained. Or what do you do in a place like, say, Malviya Nagar, or I'm not even talking urban villages. And how would, I mean, you did give some ideas that, you know, you have community spaces and all of that, but in a severe lockdown situation, what would you do? And especially when there is a family or a person who's affected by, let's say, COVID in this case, how, I mean, what I'm trying to wrap my head around is how does a space planner even get in here? Is it something, sometimes we do tend to bite off more than we can chew. So is this something that's really in our ambit, and these are unnatural circumstances? We may not always be able to design for them. All the recommendations that you mentioned, I think, should be anyways mandated because they are healthy living, pandemic or otherwise. What I'm trying to understand is how would an architect actually alleviate grief in any way other than being a good human being? It's not really a question. It is just a question to myself and to you that it's a pondering, really. How do we even claim to do anything?
Yeah, I tend to agree with what Anubha has just said. It's very informative, and this is something that we have been bombarded with this, all this information for last so many months and maybe more than a couple of years or so. But it's again, I think it's good to refresh that whatever needs to be done and what has caused all this. And the hard part is, again, what Anubha just mentioned, that as architects and physical planners, what you have just recommended are, in any way, they are, you know, the kind of standards for good neighborhood. Like, these are the planning principles which are normally followed everywhere, you know, that things should be closed and you should have open spaces and all kinds of other things, which are good recommendations. But they form part of the general knowledge about good city planning, good neighborhood and all that. Now the question is, as I also tend to agree with Anubha, that architects, planners, do we really have the wherewithal to target these questions? That's my point. Maybe over a period of time, a new course of studies would emerge, which would train us for this kind of work. But right now, I think it's very touch and go. We don't really know. I mean, for example, if it's a mass scale of contamination and a kind of pandemic, then you kind of sequester a large stadium and put people there and isolate them. Then you have places in the neighborhood. But in an existing neighborhood, these are very, like Anubha mentioned, for example, Malviya Nagar, it will be difficult to do a thing like this. So, it's kind of, what you're saying is kind of prescriptive. I don't blame you, because it's not something, if you ask me a question, I'll not be able to answer this, that how do you deal this? I think I don't expect any more than that from you either. Mm. So it's a difficult question, but I think at some point of time, we have to address this. If this keeps on recurring over a period of time, I think, which is most likely, that every few years there'll be something or the other happening. So how, and this is also not only epidemic, the whole lot of natural disasters are foretold, that something is going to happen on the coastal sides, and something is going to, the glaciers are melting and landslides are coming down, all kinds of things are happening. This is basically a disaster, not necessarily for medical reasons, but a whole lot of other things. So maybe a new course of studies would emerge, which would enable us to handle these. But a good work, piece of work. Thank you. Anybody, you have any, somebody wants to join in and ask questions, something like that?
Gunjan
has raised her
hand. Yeah. Thank you so much, sir and ma'am, for your valuable feedback. So being their guide, I would like to add something. This topic is very close to my heart because I've been one of the active sufferers during this pandemic time. And I lost my father during that time, and we tried to save him, whatever we could do, but we couldn't actually. So what you have raised as a point as an architect, how we can contribute. We definitely just cannot contribute as an architect, but all the citizens need to contribute here. The general public need to be made aware. But as architects, what we can do, at the neighborhood level, certain resources we can identify in terms of maybe temples, community halls, which could be converted to some kind of shelter or refuge. And what is most lacking during this time is some kind of personal touch. That is, we cannot meet people during that time. We cannot bid farewell to the our loved ones. So that is something which hurt the most. So if we have RWAs and other places, maybe RWAs can be mobilized in this kind of a situation, the community spaces where they can provide some kind of counseling or some kind of support even in doing the last rites for the loved ones. So all these things definitely can make a difference even in densely packed areas. So that is what I'll have to say from my personal experience. Not necessarily all the interventions had to be from the architectural point of view.
Okay.
Sure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Any other questions or clarifications? Anything? Just more.
Okay. So adding to what Gunjan ma'am mentioned, so the question was not from the architects. So we started as students and the youth of the current, which was suffering in the current situation. So we actually started as a human being and started to understand what the actual, what different age groups of people were suffering during this time. So we started to understand what grief actually was. And so through the PPT, we started with the grief, how the grief affects differently during the pandemic. And then from after understanding about the human psychology during this time, we actually tried to look into the areas which we went and talk to people. So the basic needs which were there were the spaces and the interventions we mentioned during the presentation. And so basically we tried to identify the problems at the basic level and then tried to understand from the people itself what the solutions could be.
I have to say one thing. You know, when you are close to an event of tragic nature like this, right? So we become emotional. I mean, it's a natural thing. It's not something that to be ashamed of. We become emotional and we lose the perspective, so to speak, because you are very close to something. I mean, a bomb has fallen in your neighborhood. You cannot, you know, expect that you have the right perspective. Then you are kind of reacting instantaneously, right? So at times, but I think over a period of time, I think the research that you have done, it'll help you to formulate something. I'm sure it will help you to do something later. But right now it is red hot, the whole situation. So one is not able to exactly, you know, say what is going to happen. Like Gunjan said, it was a personal tragedy for her. And so this is something very, is very, very traumatic for her. I can understand that. But so our reactions are also very kind of, what do we say, very abrupt in that sense, that we, this has to, over a period of time, I think some science would develop over this. Thank you.
If I may add, I just wanted to add that one of the things that possibly can happen, I think one of the things that has emerged in the past few months is the isolation, physical isolation, which is mandated because of the nature of the disease. And because of that, you know, I know of instances where people have been in the ICU and they've been alone. So as an architecture student or as an architect, what I probably could do is kind of develop special arrangements, whether that's for intensive care or contaminated care, where I can put my training as an architect to see how such spaces can be created where the person needn't be alone, which means there are system of screens or, you know, whatever, whether there are physical screens or, you know, what is the system, you know, when we have those systems. I mean, you have interrogation rooms where there is a one-sided glass or whatever it is, but the person is not alone. Because I know that has been the most dramatic for people, that, you know, they've not been allowed to visit and all of that. So if that is someplace in hospital or healthcare design, or even in post kind of critical care or critical care design, where as spaces, how do we design spaces where the afflicted person is not left alone and he doesn't or she doesn't feel that, and the family or the loved ones also don't feel that they can't meet. Right now, our spaces did not allow that. Even ICUs did not allow people to be able to meet because of the high contagion thing, even with the PPE and all. So as an architect, I think perhaps that's where an intervention and such facilities and how they can be prepared, where if such a situation occurs again, we do have facilities where people are not left alone on either side of the divide. So that for me would be an architectural intervention in such a situation.
The other thing that this is not exactly related to what you're saying, but I'm talking of a larger canvas here, where people are now going to the offices and all that, for example. You know, as students, you also feel isolated. I'm sure it's a terrible thing to be at home and under domestic pressure to do all kinds of things. It's a terrible thing for many of us, including me. I have to do things which I don't want to do. That's very natural. What I'm saying is, for example, you know, we're working on a project, an office project in Gurgaon. This was just before the pandemic started. And the space was designed for 400 people. It's a big advertising agency. They had 400 people had to be accommodated. So by the time the thing was finished, I think a year back or so, the whole scheme went out of the window. I mean, because there's no way you could put in people sitting, every 5 feet or something. You know, it's not possible. So they made a roster of 130 people, one third of the total strength. They would be visiting the office every alternate days and things like that. A crazy kind of a, you know, system. And there were large interaction rooms, because the way the people work has also changed. So large interaction rooms or conference rooms where you couldn't talk face to face. They suggested that they put a large sheet of glass in the front, like you have mulaqat in the prisons. Mulaqat hota na, that you talk through a phone or something, and somebody has come to visit the prisoner. So this whole new language of architecture is developing, and this is very scary at this point of time, but probably this is going to happen soon. I don't know. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for the comments. We would like to know if you'd like to take a small break right now.
Little too early in there.
Okay, sir. Then we
could continue. I think let's do one fast one.
Yeah.
What do you feel? I mean,
no, absolutely. I think it's too early in the day to take a break.
Yeah. It's too early in the day to take a break.
Sure, ma'am. Sure, sir. Ayushi, would you like to take over?
Yes, Dilav. Thank you.
We can do one around 1 o'clock or so? Half past one?
1:30, sir.
Short 1:30. One, half an hour.
Sure, sir.
Because SPA is not providing food to us.
No, I'm very sorry about that. I'm really sorry.
You can order food for us. That's okay.
No, but you can't sit together and eat it. No, you can't sit together and eat it. That's what I wanted.
Okay. Shuru karenge. Let's get started.
So, sir and ma'am, coming up next is the next group on their topic, Paradigm Shift in Medical Architecture. The pandemic was a situation of emergency that our medical infrastructure was not prepared for. There was a sudden influx of multifold patients than what the hospitals were designed to cater for. There has hence been a need to relook at hospitals in order to expand the facilities, capacity, and infrastructure. Let us welcome our next group to share their profound and significant findings with us.
Good morning, everyone. We are Balki Sulfana, Atul Raghunath, Devdutt Jayakrishnan, Ijaz Mohammed, Ivana Sajan, and Nand Kishore Ki. And we are here to present our thoughts on relooking at the spatial standards of Indian healthcare architecture post-COVID-19. We are guided by Professor Dr. Vandana Jha and Professor Dr. Anil Devan. The COVID-19 pandemic has placed an unprecedented demand on the healthcare institutions. Most hospitals in the country are not equipped to handle the high volumes of patients requiring them. A review of two early case series in China estimated that 44% of the COVID-19 infections were hospital acquired. All this chaos amidst the pandemic points a finger on the design of healthcare institutions. Common spaces in the hospital are the major ground for social interactions. 25 to 30% of the hospitals are networks of common spaces. Hence, we propose a research paper aimed to discuss the effectiveness of hospital standards for common spaces in responding to the pandemic, adding value to improving the standards of Indian healthcare architecture and paving way to integration of other aspects like service automation, ventilation, etc. Our research question focuses on how we can strengthen the spatial standards of Indian healthcare architecture for pandemic resilience. To tackle our research question, we came up with four definitive objectives. Our objectives for the research proposal includes identifying the major problem areas related to the spread of pandemic in Indian hospitals, identifying the preparedness and effectiveness of the current standards to face the challenges of pandemic situations, to pin down various defects in spatial design which led to the spread of COVID-19, and to propose new spatial standards for common spaces of Indian healthcare architecture. Our approach towards the research is initiated by identifying the problem statement. The detailed analysis of the problem helped us to derive the research question along with our objectives for the proposal. This was the pivotal point in our research since it paved the way for the identification of primary and secondary data. These data were studied together to extract the major parameters that constitute space in the built environment and healthcare architecture. Further analysis of each parameter, along with the information from the participatory observations and survey forms, helped us to frame the results of the recommended standards. It is generally accepted that no single factor is responsible for the spread of infectious diseases, regardless of the offending microorganisms. A combination of many factors and variables influence the modes of particle transmission. Hence, those parameters that govern the transmission of airborne diseases are identified from the case studies. These parameters include crowd management, spatial planning, ventilation, building envelope, building automation, and holistic wellness. Next, I would like to call upon Balki Sulfana to take it forward.
Crowd management. The crowd in the hospital comprises the patients and their bystanders, nursing staff, doctors, paramedical staff, and other auxiliary staff. Each has different purposes of their visits, and merging the user groups is the cause of the hospital crowd. Here comes the greater chances of cross infection, quarrels among the users, and urgency leads to lack of cooperation and further complications that affects the overall user satisfaction. These concerns can be approached with the practical solutions which many of the cases fail to implement. To be the first effective method, physical segregation at the entrance itself by means of the security system is a solution. Barricades, stanchions are some means that add into this. Use of mobile apps, drones for crowd surveillance, and use of AI in patient diagnosis are included in the segregation using IoT. The vertical and horizontal segregation of functions to minimize the patient interaction is mandatory. Visual clues for safe social distance spacing, the defined area mapping, is an application which can be followed even in the built examples. Separate isolation pathways and infection testing areas in the immediate locations reduces the crowd interaction towards the inner core. The buffer spaces are to be equipped with enough seating and shading, which regulates the uninfected bystander crowd flow towards the patient waiting areas. Looking at the space through the lens of spatial planning focuses on segregations of spaces so as to maximize resilience. The interaction between users, function, and management. The emphasis on infected and non-infected cases with little to no safety measures. There is no segregation of traffic and enough space to practice social distancing in circulatory areas like lobbies, entrances, and cold rows. General wards often fail in proper infection prevention and control. Not enough single rooms and convertible isolation rooms. No buffer spaces for recharging and temporary expansions. The suggested solutions are minimum of 2 exits and entrances with 2-meter width to specific areas or zones can be provided. At least 10% of the site area should be dedicated to temporary extension areas. Revisit the percentage of objects in the waiting area, minimum of 2%. Multiple inspection booths in 2-meter distance can help reduce overcrowding at triage area. Patient and public corridors should be segregated within the building with a width of 3 meters. Distance between beds in wards not less than 2.5 meters. Revising bed per area standards. Wards must maximize the number of single rooms or introduce cohorting for infection prevention and control. Buffer spaces to be made compulsory in the form of recharge rooms, semi-open or open spaces. Now, I invite Atul Rekhunath to speak about ventilation and building envelope.
Ventilation and air exchange are engineering control measures to control the concentrations of indoor respiratory aerosols so as to reduce the airborne transmissions of infectious agents. There are 3 key elements of ventilation affecting airborne infections. They are ventilation rate, flow direction, airflow pattern. Current ventilation standards for most interior spaces are established by ASHRAE. These standards have been designed with the primary goal of diluting bioeffluent and achieving acceptable levels of indoor air quality, rather than infection control, especially in common spaces of hospitals. What are the solutions for it? Maximize the usage of natural ventilation in possible spaces depending on its function and impact on external factors of the space. Increasing ventilation standards and preferring dilution ventilation, bringing in outside air to dilute the concentration of pathogens, can help in reducing far-field transmissions. HIPAA filters, UV rays, sanitation, etc. can be engineering controls used to remove respiratory aerosols. Changing the pressures of room to regulate an ordered flow of air. The airflow direction should be properly controlled from clean zones to filthy zones in ideal situation. Preventing the virus-laden aerosols transmission between the rooms. Improving the ventilation by redesigning ventilation rate, airflow direction, and airflow pattern. In our report, we have provided detailed information on new air changes per hour, MERV values for the proposed spaces. Building envelope holds importance in controlling the amount of ventilation and light in terms of wellness quotient. The materials used can affect the amount of time pathogens remain in possible contact to the environment and users. Thermal, moisture, and acoustic management are most fundamental requirements of building envelope systems. But when it comes to hospital, each fixtures and finishes are also major elements. According to WHO, 1.4 million people are affected by nosocomial infections. The lackness in dust and moisture control, especially dampness, reduces the rate of oxygen in the surroundings and leads to critical respiratory issues. When it comes to pandemic, oxygen is a fundamental requirement. The construction and renovation during the time of pandemic can also lead to many other health issues. COVID-19 can last for hours in smooth and non-porous materials like steel and glass. What are the solutions for these? All finishes and fixtures should be designed accordingly to allow easy cleaning and discourage the accumulation of dust and moisture. Especially when it comes to high-risk clinical zones, the door should be sealed. The ceiling should be monolithic from wall to wall without fissures, open joint, or crevices that may retain or permit the passage of dust. Use of antibacterial materials, photocatalytic paints, which eliminate organic and harmful components can be proposed. Now I invite Nandakishore to talk about automation in hospitals.
Thank you, Adil. Building automation. Building automation in healthcare involves the use of smart devices, softwares, and information of things to deliver medical services more efficiently. The problem areas that we identified are The inadequacy of hospital infrastructure to deploy COVID protocol can be easily tackled using smart technologies. Increasing COVID hospital accidents due to equipment malfunctioning, lack of macro awareness, and defined rules, resulting in ambiguous use and ultimately resource loss. Moving on to solutions, the application status in hospital are broadly divided into three: smart crowd management, automated disinfectioning, monitoring and alarm systems. Under smart crowd management, use of digital triage in emergency department is advised to segregate patient before first contact with the hospital staff. In OPDs and receptions, virtual queuing, online OPDs and cashless transfers should be used. In waiting area and entrances, digital announcement and touchless interfaces can be employed. Mobile navigation applications for safe and controlled navigation in hospitals can be used. Toilets can be employed with motion sensor toilet fixtures and self-cleaning toilets with automated ultraviolet C devices. Blood patient monitoring for nurse station, from nurse stations without having direct contact with the patients to determine patient's condition, position of the body, ECGs, etc., using sensors, etc. Safe alarm systems and automated shutdowns in hospital equipments or plans to avoid accidents or explosions due to equipment malfunctioning. Moving on to the holistic wellness aspect. Holistic wellness is a state of feeling happy or healthy, considering a person as a whole, taking into account mental and social factor, not merely the symptom of disease. Problem areas. When staffs are considered, extra workload demand due to current COVID situation followed by mental stress and related disorders, fear of personal safety during infection and lack of adequate PP kits, possible isolation and thus separation from their families, risk of carrying the infection to loved ones. When public is concerned, fear of getting infected from hospital, fear of safety of children. Present hospital design in India ignores universal accessibility and thus build an unsafe and unfriendly environment for people with disability, which worsens the situations like pandemic when social distancing is a mandatory. Solutions. Healing-centric design approach can help a lot to break conventional hospital environment. Natural lighting and a view of natural greenery should be enhanced. Refreshment and resting areas separately for staff and visitors can be provided near the departments. Special refreshment area for staff with PPE kit as relaxation spaces can be provided. Proper sterilizing spaces for safe undressing of PPE kit should be designed. Common leisure area for the inpatient to break away from mental stress are needed. This was found efficient in an Indian hospital where all COVID-infected patients gathered in the lobby singing and dancing, which helped them recover fast. Introducing kid zones can help parents to get rid of their fear of children's safety. CPW guidelines for a barrier-free environment should be made mandatory. Moving on to Ivana Sajjan for the conclusion part of our presentation.
As we come to the conclusion that the existing norms were not conclusive with those implemented in the recent COVID facilities and hence falls short in terms of its resilience. Summing up so far, the major areas of nosocomial transmission and areas that concerned users were determined through the primary survey and interview data. They are the admission, emergency, corridors, waiting areas, and other areas in proximity like the pharmacy, and the patient rooms and wards where there is prolonged contact. A holistic approach to the spatial standards for infection prevention and control is arrived at using the six parameters: the crowd management using optimized wayfinding, proper signage, proper spacing for seating, and deployment supplies with green buffer spaces. spatial planning strategies in terms of zoning of contaminated and clean zones, a minimum of two entrances and exits, the number of beds per area standards, and number of sanitary points are revised. Improving the ventilation by redesigning ventilation rate, airflow direction, airflow pattern, and the use of dilution ventilation and HEPA filters with revised air changes per hour. The building envelope design is determining the optimum window wall ratios, regulating the number of openings, using porous materials and monolithic ceilings to reduce the presence of pathogens. Building automation using the next step towards efficient space management with digital triaging, mobile apps, and digital monitoring. And finally, ensuring holistic wellness of staff and patients during these testing times through healing-centric design, biophilic design, buffer spaces, optimum light and ventilation, and universal accessibility. We come to the end of the presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, team. We now request the jury to give their feedback on the presentation and the audience to pose their questions in the question answer forum or the chat box.
Anubha, would you like to take up?
Aap bole.
मैं तो क्या बोलूं अच्छा बोलता हूं मैं आप कह रहे हैं तो द थिंग इज यू नो द काइंड ऑफ हाई स्टैंडर्ड्स दैट यू हैव सेट अप फॉर पोस्ट कोविड यू नो डिजाइन ऑफ हॉस्पिटल्स एंड ऑल दैट दिस आर ऑल फाइन बिकॉज दीज आई थिंक दे अप्लाई टू वेरी लार्ज मेडिकल सेंटर्स एंड फैसिलिटीज विच आर इन मेट्रोज राइट and some very well established hospitals and things like that. My concern is more for what is happening in the hinterland, what is happening in a small town, what's happening in a, you know, what would be the strategy for a place in a remote village in Jharkhand, for example. How do we deal with this? This is possible. I mean, what you're saying is all very good. For example, in large city hospitals like Medanta or, you know, Medicity or something like that. But what is, I think, crucial for us to understand is how are we going to handle the large upsurge of contamination and pandemic in places, you know, which are not well served by any system. So I think our focus should have been more on that rather than these are fine automation and all this kind of thing that you've said, you know, a large deal of a large number of measures which are kind of very, very contemporary and modern. But the crux of the problem is not here. The crux of the problem is where you handle large numbers outside. And are we able to handle those many numbers? If you go to All India Institute of Medical Sciences on a normal visiting hour day, you'll see how many people come there. It's almost, I know, I mean, it looks like an impossible task to take care of, you know, 5,000 people, you know, thronging that place, and, you know, they have absolutely no notion where to go and what kind of treatment they would get. It's a very, very difficult situation, I must say. So this is, just hold on for a second.
Shall I go while Samudra is on her way to take his call? Okay. So I think I agree with the. Sorry, Sambud. Yes, please carry on. You're on mute.
So the images I saw on the TV, you know, last few months, that was happening in these places, you know, like. In a small place in Bihar, in a small medical center, something. That is where we have to tackle things. You know, I mean, this is fine. I mean, those who can afford to do take measures like this is fine. I mean, the automation and all kinds of other things. But I think as architects, our focus should be really on how to deal with with situations which are not so conducive in terms of financing or location or the kind of attention that you get in the hospital. So that's what I had to say.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, no, I agree with most of what Sambuddha said. In fact, I had written down in my notes that the kind of hospital that you presented, it's actually, by Indian standards, a luxury hospital. To be very honest, I mean, Medanta and Medicity, as Sambuddha. It is a luxury hospital, which is not... And trust me, I know that AIIMS is an excellent hospital. The quality of doctors in AIIMS is fantastic. But go to AIIMS. And please see the physical infrastructure or any other major civil hospital in the city, wherever you may be. And just see the number of people who visit, because sadly or not so sadly, the health infrastructure in India is, the government health infrastructure in India is creaking under the load of patients simply because we have too much of a population. However, that said, doesn't mean that we kind of, you know, hang up our boots and say it cannot be done. So I think as a notion, what you say is absolutely right, and we should do it. I would just like you to think of a difference between healthcare design and hospital design, because these are kind of two things. Designing for health and designing a hospital building could be taken as two parallel and yet sort of converging things. In a situation like COVID or any other major disruption in the health system, it could be even dengue or anything, whenever there is a large number of patients other than the normal huge population that we anyways afflict, I think the difference, and in some ways Delhi government does try to do that, is that you have three layers of segregation. You have to differentiate between people who just need palliative care and people who need critical care. So somebody who just, even a COVID infected patient who is otherwise fine, doesn't have very high amount of comorbidities and just needs to be monitored and maybe regulated for a few days, he doesn't need to go to a hospital. And how does then that work in a mohalla clinic or in something akin to it? So there has to be layers of healthcare. And that is where probably as architects or planners or designers or whatever we are, we can sort of propose that at every, and it is there in the planning systems, it's just that those have to be thought. Again, I mentioned it to the first thing, and that is something that, since I also sort of bridge this thing between architecture and design, in design we talk about it very, very often, but I have not found it being talked about in architecture too often, is systems thinking. We don't think in systems. We think as standalone product, which in this, in our case, is a building or a built environment. But if you look at systems, which means that there is a difference between healthcare, in which case there can be some things like outpatient or OPD or day-to-day when somebody's not feeling well is one system which can be handled at the neighborhood level. Critical care becomes a little bit more complicated and everywhere. All these excellent guidelines that you mentioned, of course, should be put in place, but that's critical care. And you'll have to, I mean, as architects, we'll have to figure out systems where the critical or the non-critical patient is not rushed off to AIIMS for the lack of a local solution. So that is where I think that as a architects and designers or urban designers, urban planners, whatever, is that we can intervene. And there's also a very interesting question by Anubandh in the chat box, which is a very valid question, that is the research then tested, or is it a first level of research, which would be then your personal research? So I would like the team to please address that question that is there in the chat box. And then you can tell me what you think of my
own. Can I pitch in?
Yes, please.
So ma'am, various standards are actually studied thoroughly, like WHO, ASHRAE, PHO, etc. And after that, case studies also. So in the interview, we asked doctors and other paramedical staffs about the kind of, you know, standards that one must follow. And after that, after careful scrutiny with most of the standards, the common standards and those standards which are effective enough are chosen with meticulously. So that's how we arrived at these standards. So for instance, you know, I'll just give an example about air changes per hour. So which is a particular topic in ventilation. So, you know, ASHRAE gives a definite value for ventilation in toilet, let's say toilet, which is 10 ACH, right? And then PAHO gives a definite value, WHO gives some other value, and out of which the one which is most effective is chosen.
Sure. Right. So nobody is contesting that. Now, this fantastic standard that everybody has prescribed, is it actually implemented in a government hospital in India? Do we have the resource, the wherewithal, the will, all of that? Sometimes the will is there, but the people just don't have resource or access to that kind of technology or money or whatever it is. So standards are all very fine. Nobody's questioning that these standards are, as I said, that on as a conceptual kind of presentation. Yes, I agree to all that you said, but looking at the reality, and which is what I think Sambuddha was also trying to say, looking at the reality of India, can you translate all of that? In that case, what would your approach be? If I cannot give that ASHRAE recommended filter, HEPA, to say a small town clinic, I won't even say village clinic, say a small town clinic in say Barabanki. So what is the alternative? So that is where I'm saying that you will have to distinguish between, you will have to offload, reduce the load of the healthcare or the hospital system so that healthcare can be also addressed in other areas. If you can reduce the pressure of hospitals and look at sort of smaller decentralized hub and spoke kind of models of healthcare, then perhaps our hospitals will have the time and energy and resource to go into these systems, which we all agree that should be followed. Yeah. Yeah. So
Anil, you have to say something. Anil.
I don't want to say something, but I also agree that suppose we talk about WHO standard for drinking water. Nowhere in India we will get that standard. No water will come up to that level. Similar with the indoor air quality standards, air quality standards, whatever is the parts per million of air and water and amount of detergents in river water, like you said about Noida and the Chhath Puja and the water quality in the river Yamuna. So similarly, so what we are facing is the air quality, the water quality, and pollution all over the place. And hospitals are very, very polluted. Everybody knows that we go to a hospital with one disease and we come out with four other diseases. So they are so bad that we are now, it's almost better not to go to a hospital. And we are now contemplating and thinking about home-based care or other solutions, wellness centers and this, that, so many things, you know, which so they talked about building automation and all that. Maybe the telemedicine and telediagnosis and, you know, the doctor sitting there and we working on a mobile phone and trying to communicate. All these things happened during the COVID times. And now people are talking of lungs transplant. The lungs are not working at all. And they say, ki transplant kar do ji lungs ko. So all those advancements in healthcare have also happened. So that is all I have to add.
For the team, I just wanted to add one thing, that in India, I think a comparable solution, which is slightly easier in terms to study as a case study, where you might find that some standards are met. However, they are also not perfectly met. But as a parallel case study, you could do is airports. Because they have a similar, not as much crowd and not as heterogeneous a crowd as an hospital, but still these are closed environments. I don't say malls or other places because the crowd is completely different. But airport is still largely a public space, which is a contained place now. And they do, especially in the pandemic, have had to deal with all of these issues, crowd management, segregation, air filtration, and all of that. And perhaps they are a little less stressed than hospitals to study how, you know, I think I'm also responding to Manoj's comment in the box where, you know, how do you check efficacy? It may be near impossible to do it in the hospital situation, but airports could offer you a parallel, a close parallel, where then maybe some of the learnings from that situation could be implemented in a hospital situation. That is just a suggestion, just something that came to my mind.
Yes, ma'am, I agree. Ma'am, one thing that came to my mind was when we did our case study, we figured out that in China, when there was this outburst of COVID-19, so I'm just taking Chinese context, okay, and I'll compare it with India. So initially, when there was this outbreak, almost the data and the survey suggest that almost 44% of the initial COVID spread happened directly from the hospital, right? So that's really a major part of it. And China is a country with so much technological advancement. If they weren't able to control such a spread with the kind of system they had now, so I think we have to deploy resources that we have right now into our healthcare architecture in the hospitals to improve the standards, to improve the quality, to improve the parameters that we have in the current scenario.
It's a tough situation, yes, but I think at some point we have to take it up because it will be a I think basically the infrastructure, medical infrastructure in the hinterland, all small towns, mofussil towns and districts, that has to be strengthened. Only then probably we'll get somewhere. And many of these measures, for example, they may not require a closed environment.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
The more open it is, it's just a roof with no side walls.
Yeah.
That is better than having a completely air-conditioned space with lots of virus floating around. So this kind of concept, I think, if I'm not mistaken, Cuba has done a lot of work on this kind of intermediate kind of things. So which are like a halfway house between a very sophisticated hospital and something very basic. So I think we really need, as a nation, we need to really look at those systems. How this can be a halfway house between, between the two systems.
Yes, I absolutely agree. So natural ventilation and those kind of introducing the natural elements into the built space is also one of the great parameters.
For example, this is a personal, this thing, I had gone to see a doctor in All India Institute of Medical Sciences, a very famous doctor. And you'll not believe he was sitting on a chair and all the, there at least I think at in that hall there were at least 200 to 300 people and there's no place to sit. They're literally crouching on the floor.
That is the normal situation.
They're like a mela.
And AIIMS is still better if you go to Safdarjung. If you go to Safdarjung Hospital.
And what a great doctor! He says I never take a break.
Yeah.
He has an apple in his pocket. He just takes it out and eats it. So that's it. On the last minute, he goes for a loo break and comes back again, starts doing it.
Absolutely true. I mean, I've seen doctors.
I think you have to forget food. This was long before COVID.
I've seen doctors, especially senior residents in AIIMS, having 36-hour shifts.
Yes.
36-hour shifts without break. If they manage to catch 1 hour nap in between, so that's the kind of pressure they're working under.
But that's our big strength.
That is the reality.
Yeah. Our big strength.
But
that's
the thing is that what Sambuddha said, that we have to go to these halfway things. And Cuba is a very interesting example for a lot of this because Cuba has not going on to the trajectory of high technology because of the embargoes placed on it by US. So they have had to made to do with a lot of indigenous systems. And they've done pretty well, even in urban planning and urban design.
Yes.
Stunning examples from Cuba because they haven't followed the Western trajectory simply because they haven't had access to technology because US has not led them. So in a way, that has worked better for them. All this embargo.
For example, each house had a kitchen garden.
Yeah.
So they would supply all the, whatever, vegetables. All vegetables would come from that garden because otherwise it's just not available, outside, so everything is locally produced. So things like that, we have to develop such ideas probably.
So the deprivation has led them to work out a system which is largely self-sustaining and that is why it is a very interesting case study. I think increasingly we must all look at Cuba and see how it has developed those systems and worked with those.
In medicine also, I don't remember which particular treatment it was. They came out with a very low-priced thing.
Yeah.
Vaccination or something, or it was a family planning thing. I don't remember now. It was very effective. low cost and
effective. And about the sort of village situations, I know during the pandemic, I was talking to one of the ladies who worked with me, who's in a village in Rourkela, and her brother was not well. And I did mention, why don't you go to the hospital? And the reason which she gave for not going to the hospital, the local hospital or the clinic was, or the district hospital, whatever it may have been, was ki wahan kidney nikal lenge. Now that was also the kind of fear that people deal with.
That's right.
And they refuse to go to the hospital because they were like 100% sure ki wahan pe kidney nikal lenge.
Hota bhi hoga, bilkul.
Hota bhi hoga, who knows? So it is this entire thing. So again, system. You have to study the system, not just one aspect of the
system. Well, I think it's a great subject to work further on. Absolutely. I think you could carry it on further, you know, and do some more work on this. This will be very interesting. I mean, it can become a very valuable paper.
It is.
You know, for people to consult later. Thank you.
I think Dr. Jain has raised her hand. Dr. Bandana Jha.
Yeah, she has a question, I suppose.
Ma'am, you can unmute yourself and ask the question.
Sorry.
Maybe it was an accidental reason.
Okay. This is Bandana, you have a question?
Yeah.
You'll have to unmute yourself.
Okay. Unmute. No, I'm unmuted. Other Bandana has to unmute herself.
I don't think she realizes that she's had a hand up.
That may be the case.
Am I audible now?
Yeah,
audible now. Yes.
All right. Big hello to everyone. And rightly, I wanted to participate because right now I'm at Holy Family Hospital only for a medical checkup. And I was involved with these students and I feel I really like the discussions and I appreciate and thank all the judges here and all the jurors. One thing why, we have also stressed on building automation is that a certain kind of technologies that have been, being used by AIIMS has reduced a lot of their problems, in the sense that segregation of patients, the same thing what Anubha ma'am was talking about earlier, like segregation of patient at the digital level itself, before they enter the complex and, even at the segregation at the levels of where they should go, whether it should be the district healthcare facility or to the the critical hospitals. For that, the automation has really helped. Similarly, there are various kind of aspects within. I was part of the Apollo Hospital design in Mauritius and other places, and therefore use of digital spaces, digital systems has really helped in infection control, has really helped in crowd management, has really helped in many other aspects, which have actually, reduced the problems at any hospital. So therefore, they become an integral part these days for hospital design. And definitely, the students have talked about the spatial segregation and all earlier in the part of the, and what we tried to really work out together was to tackle this issue through 6 parameters. And they were all being, discussed by the students, so I would not repeat them. But definitely, I like the idea of Anubha ma'am of segregation at various levels of facilities. And I really thank you all again. And sorry, I will now discontinue. It's my turn here, so
okay.
It's okay.
But I think hope everything is okay with you. Are you okay? Okay.
Yeah, it's just a routine.
Okay, routine
medical checkup.
Okay,
routine checkup, preventive.
Very, yeah. Very, very topical.
Yeah.
Okay. Haan ji, ho gaya.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am, for your valuable comments. I'm sure the team will dwell upon the feedback. And we also thank the audience for being interactive and their interesting questions. I now hand over the stage to Tilak.
Thank you, Ayushi.
The last presentation has surely given us a glimpse into how hospitals can adapt to help the vulnerable among us, the patients. However, there are many social groups as well whom the COVID-19 pandemic has left extremely vulnerable in ways beyond just illness. With that, we would like to begin our second session of the seminar, The Vulnerable. One such group severely impacted by the pandemic are the migrant laborers, who are forced to return to their hometowns due to economic deprivation and loss of livelihood. To understand how this can be prevented, we would like to introduce the next group with their topic, Migrant Laborers and COVID-19, Response, Rehabilitation and Resilience. The stage is yours.
Thank you, Tilak. I'm Shantani Wala, and with me I have Anshul Mahur, Harshita Kamari, Khushi Sarkar, Shitija Prasad, Priyanka Agarwal and Srishti Garg as my co-authors and architect Gunjan Jain as our guide. Our topic is Migrant Laborers and COVID-19, Response, Rehabilitation and Resilience. At the onset of the pandemic, the sweeping travel restrictions and various national lockdowns left migrant laborers stranded without any opportunity to return home or to continue their journey onwards. These implications aggravated migrant vulnerabilities and left them in limbo.
आज रात 12 बजे से पूरे देश में संपूर्ण लॉकडाउन होने जा रहा है।
कहाँ पे जाएंगे? सब अलग अलग प्रांत के हैं ना, इनको छत छुपाने की जगह बारिश आए तो ना, सोने की जगह सब ऐसे ही बचा ले होंगे। बच गए तो घर जाएंगे, नहीं तो मर जाएंगे, तो रास्ते में रह जाएंगे।
The current crisis indicates a lack of urban preparedness and prompts the nation to enhance its resilience with adequate short-term and long-term responses. So what is city resilience? City resilience is the capacity of cities to function so that the people living and working there, particularly the poor and vulnerable, survive and thrive no matter what stresses or shocks they encounter. Pandemic resilience and SDGs. The UN General Assembly recognizes migration as a major contributor to sustainable development. 10 out of these 17 sustainable development goals have targets and indicators that identify migration and migrant living conditions as key aspects of sustainable development. So what exactly do we mean by migration? The International Organization of Migration defines migration as the movement of a person or a group of people either across an international border or within a state. There are majorly two types of migration, internal and external migration.
Migration is also classified under distress migration and reverse migration. Every minute, people are removed from their habitats with nowhere to go. Distress migration happens when people perceive that there is no option for them except to migrate. It is motivated by extreme economic deprivation, natural disasters, or gender and social oppression. Whereas, when people move from destination point to source point for any reason, it is known as reverse migration. The lockdowns imposed during COVID-19 triggered a mass movement from urban to rural areas. Reverse migration in India caused due to COVID-19 pandemic is a form of distress migration. Approximately 30 million laborers migrated during the lockdown between 25th March to 15 June 2020. Due to COVID-19 pandemic, India endured the second largest displaced migration in its history after the partition in 1947. To understand how migration was affected by the pandemic, we sought to look at the migration streams that existed in India before the outbreak of COVID-19. Before the pandemic, in-migration states, rates were higher in high-income states like Delhi and Maharashtra, while low-income states like Uttar Pradesh and Rajasthan had higher rates of out-migration. For the scope of our study, rural to urban migration is of the most significant. To understand the reverse migration that happened during the pandemic, we did a field study of one of the megacities in India. India has five megacities, namely New Delhi, Mumbai, Kolkata, Chennai, and Hyderabad, with over 10 million people in each. Delhi is the largest metropolitan city in India and is a powerful magnet for internal migration in the country. Its highest per capita income among other states makes it a highly preferred destination for migrants from all over the country. According to the National Sample Survey of 2007 and 8, about 43% of Delhi's population are migrants. As can be seen in the chart below, the major influx of population was sourced from Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, and Rajasthan. Migration from these states was male-dominated, and work or employment was cited as the most common reason. When the state borders were sealed in March 2020, the workers were left stranded. According to the survey done during the pandemic by the Housing and Land Rights Network, migrant labor left Delhi majorly because of loss of housing due to eviction or inability to pay rent. Only 55% received full dues from their employers, remaining received partial payments or none at all.
Our primary field study is based in Delhi and addresses the migrant laborers working in the construction sector. The construction sector was one of the worst affected sectors. Therefore, in the finite time frame and to limit the scope of the research, we conducted interviews only with migrant construction workers. We considered four construction sites in Delhi, namely Hansraj College in Kamla Nagar and Ashok Vihar B Block, both in Northwest Delhi, Unity Eleganta Mall in Netaji Subhash Place in Central Delhi, and Lakshmi Nagar F Block in East Delhi. The survey had 42 participants and it was designed to understand the migrant workers' living conditions, the problems faced by them during the pandemic, and the factors that forced them to return to their hometowns. It was observed that 70% of the participants are below the age of 45 years. 78.6% of the workers were males who worked on construction sites from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. The female workers also worked as household help. Most of them have hometowns in Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Jharkhand, and West Bengal. 35.7% migrant workers moved to Delhi alone and sent expenses back home, while 64.3% migrated with their families. Of the workers we interviewed, 33.3% were daily wage workers, while 45.2% worked on contractual basis under their employer. About 50% of the interviewees had been living in Delhi for more than 10 years. During the pandemic, most interviewees experienced loss of employment, housing, and a lack of money and food. Given the nature of the disease and its rapid spread, most of them also experienced a lack of masks and sanitizers.
Due to the reasons mentioned before, 59.5% of the interviewees migrated back to their hometowns, while 9.5% of them were stranded on their way back. Most migrant workers surveyed did not have access to adequate housing in Delhi as per international human rights laws and standards. About 66.60% of survey respondents have been living in Delhi on construction sites with bare minimum exposure to basic living conditions, while 21.4% people were living in rented accommodation. 11.10% of respondents were living in informal settlements like Jhoggi-Jhopri clusters, unauthorized colonies, etc., while the rest are sleeping in rickshaws, on footpaths, and on roads. Thus, we see that the large-scale reverse migration during the pandemic was triggered by a variety of push and pull factors. The migrant construction laborers faced many challenges during the lockdown period, including loss of jobs, loss of housing, lack of money, and lack of food. These constituted the major push factors in driving a large number of migrant workers back to their villages. A large majority of migrants had access to some form of housing back in their hometowns in form of jointly owned houses or kaccha pakka houses, which became a considerable pull factor in addition to agriculture work and being reunited with their families in uncertain times.
अधिकार है, रह रहे हैं तो उसके पास काम कर रहे हैं तो और नहीं करेंगे तो हमारा अधिकार नहीं है.
These projects belong to different typologies, namely residential, educational, and the commercial sector. The sites were all handled by different contractors, including both private and government contractors. We noticed that the workers who had on-site accommodation and partial wages were able to stay in Delhi, even during the lockdown period, while many were daily wages workers and were evicted from their homes due to inability to pay rent. Therefore, we concluded that access to adequate and affordable housing can help the cities to be more resilient towards reverse migration.
After looking at the on-ground scenario, we sought to look at some of the states and cities which were able to survive the pandemic through their emergency response measures and long-term resiliency efforts. The COVID-19 pandemic inspired various forms of relief measures all over the world, and some of the emergency response measures taken are as shown. Support for payment through financial aid and reduction in rent, prohibition of eviction by providing incentives for landlords and an additional period to pay off rent, postponement of rental payments through extension in moratoriums, provision of temporary shelter and allocation of emergency housing in vacant units through emergency shelter systems, mobilizing gyms to host homeless and increase food distribution service, the substitution of tourist apartments for medium and long-term rentals and converting vacant housing. The experience of various countries showcase that adequate shelter provision is the key to increasing a state's disaster preparedness. Some of the schemes and provisions adopted internationally include providing financial aid to encourage home ownership, supporting group housing and its construction, converting existing structures and vacant or neglected properties, integrated community development, aiming to develop new and replacement of social housing units. Indian states took various measures to support migrant laborers during the pandemic, and a few of them include providing additional finance assistance and giving salaries in advance, offering twice the amount to workers who returned, and announcing skill training programs. Apart from this, we analyzed long-term resiliency measures in four Indian cities, namely Pune, Surat, Ahmedabad, and Indore. Pune's pull factors like job opportunities and education resulted in an increased demand for housing. And to compensate for the lack of affordable housing for the skilled laborers, initiatives like Lok Awas Yojana, Valmiki Ambedkar Awas Yojana, and Smart City Plan were introduced. Surat and Ahmedabad have a large migrant population due to high demand of labor for textile and diamond industries. They envisage a zero slum area and are planning to construct 10,200 housing units under a public-private partnership program. Indore attracts a lot of migrants because of its varied trade and cultural history, but 28% of its population lives in slums. Therefore, housing construction and rehabilitating the poor through mass housing projects is given priority.
Having studied these examples, we thoroughly analyzed the affordable housing policies and schemes underway in Delhi and their achievements and shortcomings. Some of the policies which we will be looking into are as follows. The DSIIDC Housing for Poor benefits the economically weaker and focuses on building cheaper and environmentally compatible houses using eco-friendly materials. Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban Housing for All by 2022 helps the urban poor, including slum dwellers, and emphasizes on slum rehabilitation with the participation of private developers. Under the Jahan Jugi Wahan Makan scheme, people who are forced to shift in slums will be given flats and rent till the construction of flats in peri-urban areas of Delhi. Land pooling policy aims at reorganizing land use to provide 17 lakh housing units in 95 urbanized villages to meet the growing housing needs of its residents. Recognition of property rights of residents in unauthorized colonies secures the rights of ownership or transfer or mortgage in favor of residents. The affordable rental housing complexes focuses on the existing vacant housing stock, which will be available for development by public or private entities, ensuring a dignified living environment for urban poor. Delhi slum and JJ rehabilitation and relocation policy aims on the in-situ rehabilitation and the provision of basic civic amenities for the inhabitant of the basties.
हम उनका इंतजाम कर रहे हैं। अभी तक हमने आपके खाने और रहने का इंतजाम किया हुआ था। मेरी आपसे निवेदन है, पहला निवेदन तो यह दिल्ली छोड़ के मत जाइए।
The measures taken by the state and central government to make Delhi resilient include emphasis on housing for the marginalized in the master plans over the years. DDA has focused upon diverting the wave of migrant workers coming to the city to the ring towns, settling them in the outskirts of Delhi, where work opportunities were being made.
The Master Plan of Delhi 2041 is the first to showcase the location of unauthorized colony and their expanse on the map. The government is trying to accommodate the need of the migrating population by diversifying affordable housing solution for them. The Delhi MPD 2041 includes green and sustainable environment, cleaning of the Yamuna, enhanced mobility by cleaner fuels, focusing on hospitality and service sector, addressing housing needs of poor migrants and low income groups. Section 4 of MPD 2041 talks about shelter and social infrastructure. It advocates densification of urban villages and in situ slum rehabilitation scheme to reduce the threat of eviction. Section 6 of MPD 2041 talks about disaster preparedness and resilience through promotion of mixed-use development and affordable housing option within the city boundaries, along with mandatory development of open areas and promotion of better habitat design. After examining the plight of migrant laborers in Delhi, India, and all over the world, during the COVID-19 pandemic, we tried to identify what could be the way forward and how we can make our cities more resilient. Even though there are various affordable and rental housing policies acting in Delhi, its implementation is a big challenge due to the complexity of the authorities concerned. The fundamental constraints studied in the research are the unavailability of land, the tedious approval process for land acquisition, and the construction process. Additionally, a decline in rental housing and fixation of ownership of housing induced a huge demand and supply gap in the housing sector. We have arrived at the following recommendation: migrant mapping involving NGOs and individuals, simplification of process, inclusive land use plans, focus on rental accommodation and hostels, reformulation of rehabilitation policy, rethinking housing standard post-COVID, and improved on-site living condition for laborers. The study of exemplar national and global practices help in understand and broaden the idea of furthering inclusion to benefit migrant laborers. This in turn leads to a more holistic framework that can guide our cities to become more resilient against grave issues like pandemic-induced reverse migration. Thank you.
Thank you, team. We now request the jury to give their feedback on the presentation and the audience to pose their questions in the Q&A forum.
I think it's a good presentation. I think this seminar has its heart in the right place, because this is one of the most wretched scenes we had seen during the pandemic. People marching home with, you know, this woman with her two kids on the, you know, tagging along, and then you have a big suitcase and some large bedding. So it was very, very heartbreaking. This whole scene was something that we'll never forget, this long march. So this is something I think is very topical. But the question is, I have a couple of questions. How much does a building laborer make in a day? How much money does he make? Any idea?
So for the daily wage workers, they earn around 500 rupees per day. And that
per
is,
day?
Yes, okay. That is also according to the kind of work they are doing. And the minimum we recorded is 200 rupees per day.
What is it? Sorry, again?
The daily wage is also according to the kind of work they are doing.
Yeah, yeah. But what is the minimum? Is there a mandated minimum wage also, right? How
200 much is that? Rupees, sir. Yes.
200, is it?
A day, yeah. Per day.
Okay. Now the question is, you know, then when we say talk of affordable housing, what is an affordable housing? That's the question that, you know, bothers me a lot. How much is an affordable housing? If you want to buy one or rent one, what would be the scale of saying, you know, money we're talking about? Any idea what would be the, you know, somebody, a migrant laborer wants to buy one of those affordable housings or wants to rent a house, which is a proper house. I'm not saying it's a jhuggi or a plastic tent, but something that he has to stay with, family, two children, and, you know, husband, wife, two children, and some cooking facilities, and some maybe an individual toilet or a shared toilet or something. So how much does it roughly? Because this is something that's very, very critical to the whole question of affordability. Any idea how much would it cost? I have no idea. That's why I'm asking, because this has become very popular. This affordable housing. What is affordable? I can afford something that person may not afford something. So what is affordable? This is something has been coined by the builders lobby. So, you know, they have somehow coined this thing, and they're passing it on as affordable housing. I don't know what is an affordable housing. So any notions on that? How much, what is an affordable housing? How much does it cost?
Sir, according to the Builders Association, if it's under 60 square meters and the overall price of the housing is below 45 lakhs INR, it's considered under affordable housing.
Okay. So let's go by that. Say it says 45 lakhs. You think anybody in the bracket you are talking about would be able to ever afford that? No, it's something that keeps hanging in the air. You know, this is a question that bothers us a lot. Would they ever have a roof on their heads? That's the question I'm asking. Would they ever be able to live in a city like Delhi and, you know, have a decent, healthy accommodation? Is it possible?
Yes, this is something which we also faced as a question. And what we thought about it is probably the government needs to state the standards of affordable housing as something else, especially in a city like Delhi, where the cost of living is already higher, but they are forced to stay over there because of the work opportunities over there. And because the COVID-19 pandemic started this wave of reverse migration, and it needed to be stopped because of varied reason we discussed. The government needed to do something, not only provide them with some sort of shelter and temporary allocations, but also provide a more long-term resiliency effort in terms of other sorts of affordable housing, and probably lower what the standard of affordable housing has been said. Like you said, the INR 45 lakhs, it's a lot for the people who are daily wage earners, and they are earning this much at this scenario.
Anubha, ma'am has a question, I think.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, so taking on what Sambuddha said, I think you're mixing two issues here. One is affordable housing. The other is migrant reverse migration. In my opinion, the best thing that could have happened to India in the pandemic was the reverse migration, because it offloaded concentrated urban clusters and stopped a kind of a, because of the contagion, the situation that could have imploded. And this is my hypothesis. I have not tested it, but I feel that in a way, people going away, as you said, they had pull factors. They had some shelter, they had some food, self-grown or otherwise, and they had family. we talk about quality of life. What do you need? You need shelter, you need food, and you need an environment, right? That's what they were aiming for. And I think that's the best thing they could have done. Where we stumbled was in providing them the transport to go. So I think you're mixing two issues. I wouldn't actually at all subscribe to the idea of having everybody permanently relocate to Delhi. And therefore, yes, I would say that in my opinion, there are two issues. One is adequate temporary housing for people who are here for work. Yes. And a kind of a network, transport or otherwise, which allows them to go back in a dignified and a comfortable way to their homes, towns, home villages, native places, whenever they so wish to, without having to walk. Even if they had to walk, could it be done in a manner where there are pit stops, where they could stop, where they could rest, and where they could continue their journey? I think those are two issues. I wouldn't for a moment advocate the fact that all people working in Delhi have to live in Delhi forever. That is the worst thing we could ever, ever, ever imagine. So therefore, let's not mix it with affordable housing. And as Sambhuda very rightly pointed out, what is affordable housing? 45 lakhs? Even I can't afford 45 lakhs. Yeah, forget it. The other thing is this peri-urban. I have seen situations where you make these so-called affordable housing and you shift these people to peri-urban areas. Many of them, and this has happened in my lifetime in South Delhi where I live, many jugis have been, and the place that many of them have were transported to was Madanpur Khadar, okay, which was a peri-urban area at one point. And many of these people used to work in houses in South Delhi and they couldn't afford to travel to come to work, because it was expensive. And then they take these shared rickshaws or whatever, and there's a whole lot of systemic exploitation that happens. It was perfectly fine while they were living in these so-called slums or whatever. So this whole notion of constructed affordable housing is the biggest myth. When I joined architecture in 1987, we've been talking about it since then. And it's not kind of gone away, this specter or this monster of affordable or Juggi resettlement site and services, you know, the Hajar avatars that it has taken, and it has not gone away. So I think the idea is that we should actually not at all encourage any kind of housing in the city. What you should encourage is temporary situations which are dignified, adequate, have a quality of life, which can be the onus of the construction site. You yourself in your research have mentioned that two of the better sites where there was the Subhash place, and the two commercial, one was a commercial and one were actually doing some sort of a, because that's now as a part of the building mandate, it was the residential level where architects like you and me who take these projects and have a contractor who builds these projects where these systems were not put in place. So, and that is a system that's soon ending. I mean, I don't see too many private houses being built in a city like Delhi anymore because there is no space, period. Thode din tak ye builder wale banayenge to wo bhi khatam ho jayenge jaldi. There's not much space left. So I would say that let's not mix the issue of affordable housing, whatever that may be, or urban affordable housing, with this issue of people who come from outside the state to large cities to work. We should totally, totally encourage them to go back to their native places once or twice a year during festivals and maybe otherwise during harvest time, because somebody needs to harvest that place also, and definitely have systems in place, again, systems which facilitate their transport or their journey back to their hometowns. And that probably is an issue that we should look at rather than trying to accommodate them in the city.
Rajana has a question, I think.
Ma'am, you're on mute. Ranjana, ma'am, you're on mute.
Okay. Can you just show your slides again? Can you share your screen again? Yeah. And one of the last one, you know, where there was this arrow with a lot of people in it. Last among the last. Just scroll down on this side. I'll tell you which one. Just keep scrolling down. This one. Yeah.
The one.
Where did you get this arrowhead from? Was this copied?
And we took the PNGs and we made it.
Yes. I made it. Then why are all the women wearing skirts? This is detail that I expect from people from SPA to be very, very conscious of. Okay. Otherwise, your seminar was a good one and all that. And that's why I'm saying, when everything was so good, why this?
Thanks.
I just had to make one point that, most of the, you have some interesting visuals, photographs where you show how these people are living in, in building sites. Now, under contractual obligations, all contractors are supposed to provide them hygienic living accommodations, which none of them do. And what they do is they put them up in a semi-finished floor and then expect them to survive. Mm-hmm. Or they put some juggies and things like that. So that's one, that's a major problem. And I think what Anubha said, that we need to put, I think the focus should be now on affordable, something that can be cheaply constructed and hygienic and,
and temporary.
Temporary.
And completely temporary.
I think last year, a couple of theses were made on this subject. But unfortunately, they turned into permanent projects, which is, I think, I agree with you, it's not the right thing to do. Because the moment to make a permanent multi-storied building with lifts and elevators and all the FAR regulations, you are falling into the same trap housing and all that. They will never be able to afford. And the other problem that happens is this immediately becomes gentrified. If you make a housing, if, for example, in Greta Kailash Part 2 or something, and immediately they'll sell it off to somebody, a young architect or somebody, or he just got married, this couple, so thing like that. So they're constantly being they're gentrified, so they don't retain those houses. That's another problem in Delhi. They never retain those houses. They'll sell it off, they'll make money and go away and live in a jhukki.
It's the same in Bombay and Bangalore.
Exactly.
Priyanka has her hand.
Yes, ma'am. So we do agree that we do not need permanent housing for everyone, but we took the fact that the government mandated the lockdown and it was said that people should not move from their places. But even though they wanted, some of them did want to go back. So in that case, the government should have, as you said, very rightly, a transportation system to facilitate the movement back home. But there were some people who were there with their families, with small kids, who did not necessarily want to go back home and wanted to wait till government had a transportation system in place. But they were forced to go back home. Now, what we are focusing on the fact is that people should not be forced to go back home just because they did not have adequate living measures. So even during our survey, we identified that the places not on the basis of affordability, but adequacy, and Anchal has to add to this.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Priyanka. To support Priyanka's statement, why we did the primary case study, we observed that few of the participants, the interviewees, were living in the rented accommodation of one room and a bathroom accommodation. They were paying rent of around 3,000 rupees for a month, and their wage was around 6,000 if we calculate 200 per day. And we also observed that there were few families which we interviewed, and in this pandemic situation, they didn't want to go back to their house, their hometowns. And because they were forced, because they were living on site and they were forced to evict from that site, they were helped by someone and they stayed in someone's parking lot for a whole period of pandemic, in the open space of parking lot. So in these conditions, we want to provide them with something which they can afford, which can help them in these kind of conditions where they are forced to go back.
Completely agree. This has to be a temporary housing then, and not necessarily permanent affordable housing. So, and I do know, to defend the government here, but please keep in mind that this was a situation that was unprecedented. Everybody was caught unaware, And I do know, because right behind my house in the government school, a camp was set up. I'm sure it was a kind of a chicken and egg, in the sense the media highlighted these cases of people walking back, and Delhi government, that is Delhi government only, I can't speak for others, did set up these schools, and their DTC buses, I've seen myself, were, they were at an average every day, there were the 50 buses every day that left from just one school, one government school behind my house. So I think the system did kick into place. It might have taken some time, and I'm sure there was a lot of discomfort and of unease, and also plain simple tragedy that many people had to face. I also think there was a bit of a panic created by media, which led to people just picking up their bags and walking. The first lot, I'm sure that, yes, of course, there were people who didn't have wages and who didn't have place to stay, and all that was true, not undermining that in any way. But there was also a kind of a panicky, given the nature of the pandemic also. So one of the reasons, if you had time and if you spoke to all the people, and, you know, these questions don't come up when you do an interview. They come up in conversations, and that needs time. And I know we never have time, but in conversations, you might have discovered many of them saying that, you know, we just thought it's better to go home because Delhi mein kya hoga kuch keh nahi sakte. Kyunki ye bimari jo aisi hai, phailti hai. They themselves, I mean, you know, don't undermine the native intelligence of every human being. The systems could have helped them, and they did eventually. Systems did kick in. We'll have to be a little considerate, but on the larger scale, on an everyday scale, now that we have seen it, we should be in better readiness and resilience. And these temporary measures, hostels, whatever's, should be probably, it is like a disaster situation. So like in disaster, we have disaster shelters. I think in such a situation, what you need is a disaster shelter and not housing. And that probably is the difference.
Interestingly, you know, I don't know whether you've seen this. IKEA has developed a kind of kit, which can be opened up and turned into a house very, very fast, very interestingly designed. That's exactly the kind of thing one would expect. And it's not very expensive. Yeah. I mean, they had developed it for, again, I think, for immigrants from, I don't know, from some, the Syrians who were coming into Europe, yeah, and things like that, yeah, and camps, yeah, for them. So that kind of thing, which is kind of very, it's very flexible and kind of cheap. And a kind of temporary thing, but it has all the things that are needed. The only thing is that probably the toilets are shared. That I don't remember now what it was. It's a very, very minimum kind of a shelter, but all the it works beautifully. So you can see in IKEA, I don't know what they're calling
it. A lot of solutions. A lot of people cardboard.
IKEA started selling it, I think, as a matter of fact.
So I think, again, the difference that I would like to just stress is that what you probably need to look at is disaster housing rather than affordable housing.
That's right. Okay, good, very good. I like, you know,
I like that, yeah.
It's very, very nicely done. Good.
Yes, ma'am. Adding to your last point, exactly. The situation was unprecedented for. So that's why our scope of the research went to how can we enhance our city resilience to prevent the reverse migration. Also, we could look at reverse migration in two aspects, both as a boon and as a huge disaster. So the issue was, because this whole situation was uncalled for and it happened sudden, all of a sudden, reverse migration started happening at a higher pace. The government was not prepared for it. So this would lead, when they go to their source points, that where there is not enough transport facilities, healthcare facilities, the source points wouldn't be able to handle. So definitely government needs to look into transportation aspect as well. But we as architecture students, we are looking into the aspect how long-term resiliency efforts can be done in from architectural background. That's why we limited to our affordable housing, and we looked into disaster housing, disaster architecture as well, and we studied the multiple the schemes and policies which different nations have followed of exemplar nature, and also few cities in India which performed better in handling the situation than Delhi.
Which cities handled it better?
Ma'am, we studied Pune, Indore, Surat, and Ahmedabad.
And do they have the same number of people who migrated?
No, Delhi has a very high in-migration rate, but some cities like Indore, 28% of the entire population lives in slums. So it was very difficult to handle, and still they were able to handle that situation better than them.
I wouldn't make such a blanket statement, but let's leave it at that.
Yeah.
What about rental housing? You didn't think of that.
I think Gunjan wants to say something.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. Actually, I was going to make the point what Ranjana ma'am has raised. One of the major emphasis in the research was on the affordable housing rental complexes. So we never emphasized permanent affordable housing, but what we intended is these rental complexes should be arranged. And in a time of pandemic, encouraging the migrants to go back can spread the disease to the source point. So that is also one point that we need to consider. So in that case, vacant housing, wherever involving private developers, we need to promote rental complexes. Even on a long-term measure, rental houses and construction sites providing decent shelter to the laborers could be a long-term solution.
So we studied the ARHCs, the affordable rental housing complexes also, and according to the data provided in their official site also. So the scheme is very good, but where it's lacking is in terms of implementation. Only 2.2% has been implemented, and that also not in Delhi. So we were looking into how it can be well implemented in Delhi also. Somewhere it's lacking. So maybe spread more awareness, maybe give more incentives to government workers, to school teachers, to spread the word why it lacked in terms of implementation also.
See, other thing that is very important is, for example, you are a building laborer and you should be close to wherever you're working. I mean, if you're working in South Delhi and you were in Patparganj, they have put you up. Mm-hmm. Your affordable housing, that's a difficult thing. It has to be localized.
Yes.
That makes it more topical, you know, in this, if you are close to the building site, that makes it more convenient for everybody. Otherwise, very difficult. You'll be spending all your money on, you know, transportation, pay 100 rupees a day or something that they can ill afford.
Exactly. That is why we didn't concentrate on the peri-urban. So there is two kinds of rental housing complexes provided by the government right now. One is in the cities near their workplaces, another is in peri-urban areas. So this is exactly why we concentrated more on the work areas. And in our recommendations also, we suggested within a 5-kilometer radius, these allocations should be made. Although in the government, in many schemes and many documents like Griha, they have provided brownie points for people who give the accommodations within 2-kilometer radius. But again, that is also very difficult to do. So we stretched our limit and said, okay, maybe the implication should be among the 5-kilometer radius. So that could they don't have to spend more on the transportation, and it can be localized centers.
Okay. Good.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you, team. Thank you. Thanks to jury for their comments. And team, we have a few questions in the chat box. I think some of them partly you answered during the course of your discussion. Could you please go through them and answer them at some case when you've talked?
Rajiv.
There is a question from Mr. Anuban. Does the research team has conducted any assessment of state housing policy for affordable and number of daybed service from each state?
Yes, sir. We did convey a student level assessment and analysis on the government schemes, central government and also the state government provided schemes. And I can just show once again. We tried to analyze where it's lacking, whether it's in terms of the policy itself or was it in terms of the implementation. So these were the few central government and also state government schemes and policies we looked into. And apart from that, we looked into
These are all housing. These are not temporary housing schemes.
So for that reason, we looked into Delhi MPD. So we studied how the stages of Delhi MPD has proceeded and also what 2041 has to say. So these two main things which we highlighted was shelter and social infrastructure and disaster preparedness and resilience in physical infrastructure department. But we studied the rest of the Delhi MPD also, whichever was closely linked to the keywords like urban poor, migrant workers, disaster preparedness, and affordable housing for the urban poor.
We have another question from Mr. Vinod Kumar. It's a common political question. Delhi is having about 3,000 unauthorized, regularized and unauthorized housing, and more than 95% are non-engineered housing units. Most of the citizens and the construction workers stay in this. Suggest a suitable measure for structurally safe housing.
Yeah, so our scope of this study was limited to more like policy level recommendations. That's why we didn't go into core architectural details. And we have given suggestions for the government or any other NGOs in that aspect. Yes, sir, Anupam, sir.
No, my question was not just about the assessment of the whether it is affordable permanent or affordable temporary. I agree with completely with Anubha Madam that it needs to be a temporary housing that needs to be in focus. My question was that whether you could correlate the, first of all, whether you could assess the policy, and then you could correlate the result of that assessment with the amount of exodus which has happened, which you are calling as reverse migration. I'm calling as exodus, which means laborers going back to their home. So how effective is the policy and whether it has worked for reduction of laborers going back home? Whether such study was conducted is my question. I'm not saying that this need to be conducted.
Sir, I would like to answer this on their behalf.
Sure.
Because of the time limitation, we would have loved to do that, but we couldn't do such kind of an assessment. Though we considered like what are the policies they have and what is the success rate, but comparing it with the reverse migrants, definitely the group didn't get time to do that. But definitely that's a very good suggestion, and they hope to take it further, and they can definitely take this up.
Thanks for your answer.
We also have a very relevant comment from Professor Manoj Mathur regarding the decision of whether permanent or temporary housing. He talks about the desire of people to move to urban amenities, especially education and healthcare. So we would like to register that. The jury members, we are ahead of schedule by 15 minutes. Should we break
yes,
for lunch now?
Yes, please.
So, Ranjana ma'am, shall we have a discussion with the jury for 5 minutes before?
Oh, God.
Jury? So, we can go to the breakout rooms, or how do we do it, Tilak?
We do what?
Breakout rooms are there in the Google Meet where 4 of us can meet.
Yeah.
Just for the meet. Did not do that?
But I haven't.
The technical team was.
The most
technical team. Where's the technical team?
I have a more physical need. I need to eat.
Just a minute. I'll just let you do that.
Aman Ran.
Yeah, I'll just set it up.
Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
And we meet at 2 o'clock.
Yes,
that's good.
There are many, ma'am. Like, we have just through with 4. I think 5 more.
There are 5 work. More are there, ma'am.
Ek aur karna, you want to do another?
I'm hungry.
No.
Ma'am, we'll take only 5 minutes. Just 5 minutes discussion
take
about
the market. Okay. As you wish.
But if it is taking long,
No,
you can
take a breakout room. It's not so difficult. Aman.
You can
get us there quickly.
Can somebody make me a co-host?
I can do.
Yeah,
Aman is.
We're working on the breakout room.
Yeah.
The rest of you can leave then if you want to. You can join.
No, I think then they may have issues joining, but you can hang around here if they don't have any issues.
Isn't it, Gunjan?
Yeah.
You can ask the rest of them to leave, no? They can go and take a break or whatever they want to do. Or have lunch.
There are many, ma'am, here. Maybe they won't like to leave from the... I really don't know how they... So we all are leaving from this.
No, no, you can just let them leave. No. They can all take a break or whatever.
Basically, they are now free to do whatever they want to till 2 o'clock.
I mean, if it's taking too long, then maybe we can just do a quick video call, ma'am, or audio call, WhatsApp call.
That makes always done.
Yes, that's better.
What?
Amin, we couldn't hear you.
Ma'am, he was saying that it was almost done.
Yeah, it's almost done.
It's almost done.
So we have to join this Anubha ma'am and Sambuddha sir. This is the meet link. I think it has come here. We can join this.
Mm-hmm.
Dear participants, we are breaking for lunch and we will meet again at 2. Thank you.